हरे 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 राम हरे रामा राम राम हरे 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 कृष्णा हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे 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 रामा 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 हरे 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 कृष्णा 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 हरे 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 रामा 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 हरे 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 कृष्णा 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 हरे 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 रामा 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 हरे 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 कृष्णा 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 हरे 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 रामा 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 हरे 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 कृष्णा 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 हरे 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 रामा 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 हरे 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 कृष्णा हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे 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 रामा राम राम हरे 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 कृष्णा हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे 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 रामा राम हरे 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 कृष्णा 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 हरे 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 रामा रामा हरे 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 कृष्णा कृष्ण कृष्ण हरे 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 रामा राम हरे 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 कृष्ण 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 हरे 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 राम हरे 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 कृष्णा कृष्ण कृष्णा हरे 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 राम हरे हरे जय गौरनिताय गौरनिताय जय गौरनिताय जय जय प्रभुपाद 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 जय जय प्रभुपाद जय जय गुरुदेव 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 जय जय गुरुदेव।
हरे कृष्ण हरि नाम संकीर्तन की जय। श्री प्रभुपाद की जय। श्री गुरुदेव की जय। थैंक यू प्रभु।
थैंक्स रवण प्रभु। गौरव प्रभु कैन वी गेट स्टार्टेड राइट नाउ? Or are we waiting for any more people to join?
I think we can start, Prabhu. We have around 35 devotees as of now.
So, which all groups are there in this session, Prabhu? It's your group, the Bhakti Viksha, then Saranam Prabhu's groups.
And I would like to know if any other devotees have also invited their Bhakti Viksha group members.
Is there a question for
I think
everyone, Gaurav Prabhu?
Yeah, so Ranchor Prabhu has also basically invited his Bhakti Riksha. Okay. And I'm just checking with the if any other devotees also invited their Bhakti Riksha team member.
Hare Krishna, Gaurav Prabhu, Shiv Kumar here.
Yes, Prabhu.
Yes, I have joined and I have also invited my. My members also, team members. One of them have joined already.
Okay.
Sure. Thank you, Shukumar Prabhu.
Harini Mataji is also there.
Okay.
And Sanatan Prabhu is saying few devotees from Lomlur as well has joined.
Okay, that's nice. That means you actually got all of them together now.
Yes, Prabhu.
Okay, that's interesting. That's nice. Good. So, okay, let me get started. Let's actually do our prayers to the spiritual masters before actually we get started with the session. स्वयं रूप कदा मह्यं ददाति स्वपदान्तिकं वन्देऽहं श्रीगुरु श्रीयुतपादकमलं श्रीगुरुवैष्णवांशः श्रीरूपं साग्रजातं सहगण रघुनाथान्वितं तं सजीवं साद्वैतं सावधूतं परिजनसहितं कृष्णचैतन्यदेवं श्रीराधाकृष्णपादा सहगणललिता श्रीविशाखावितांश हे कृष्णा करुणा सिंधु दीनबंधु जगतपते गोपेशा गोपिका कांता राधा कांता नमोस्तुते तप्त कांचन गौरांगी राधे वृंदावनेश्वरी वृषभानुसुते देवी प्रणमामि हरि प्रिये वांछा कल्पतरुभ्यश्च कृपा सिंधुभ्यो च पतितानां पावनेभ्यो वैष्णवेभ्यो नमो नमः नमो विष्णुपदाय कृष्णप्रेष्ठाय भूतले श्रीमते भक्तिवेदान्त स्वामित्य नामिने नमस्ते सरस्वती देवे गौरवाणि प्रचारिणे निर्विशेष शून्यवादि पश्यते देशतालिने जय श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्रीअद्वैत गदाधर श्वासदि गौर भक्तवृंद हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे 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 राम 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 हरे हरे ओके हरे कृष्णा सो सो आई हैव अ कपल ऑफ स्लाइड्स एक्चुअली वांटेड टू शेयर ऑन टुडे सेशन सिंस गौर प्रभु एक्चुअली आस्क्ड मी to speak on a few topics which are actually very relevant for some of the devotees who have been in Krishna consciousness for quite some time. So this is what actually I'm planning to talk about. So we all know most of the Vaishnavas. I hope actually there is no first timers in the sense who's not even chanting Hare Krishna, who's just coming for the first time to attend a program like this. This might sound a little bit heavy for them, but those who are actually in Krishna consciousness for quite some time and they understand what is Ekadasi, what are the different festivals that we have in Krishna consciousness, and then who is a guru. If you know all the basics of this, then it's good. Okay. So we all do Ekadasi. So what I'm going to talk about, I'll just give you a brief overview of the agenda. So one thing is we all follow Ekadasi. But then when it comes to Parana time, that is a breakfast time, many people don't understand what it is all about. Many people don't break it. So they just ignore that part. So that's one thing many people wanted to know. At least Gauru Prabhu said he wants to actually understand this for the team. The second thing is basically about, we have something called a Ritvikism, which is again, they also follow Krishna consciousness, but then it's a slight deviation in the Parampara system. So I want to actually talk a little bit about Ritvikism. Gaurav Prabhu, can actually have everyone muted? If they want to talk, you can always unmute them.
Yes, Prabhu. I'm muting them. Yeah.
Okay, thank you. The third one which I want to talk about is Bhadra Purnima Festival, which is actually coming up right now. The September 2nd onwards, we have a festival which is a very auspicious month for distributing Srimad Bhagavatam. Buying, distributing, gifting, all these things, actually it's very useful for people who want to go back to Godhead, right? And then Saravana Prabhu's team actually had a couple of questions. One was, how do I actually balance my professional work, that is my office life, with spiritual life? How do I actually balance both of them? Where should I focus more? Where should I focus less? How does it work? And the last one is basically, how do we increase our commitment towards Krishna consciousness? We know that by following Krishna consciousness, we can go back to Godhead, but how much is too much? How do I know that actually I've hit the limit in my life? Am I doing the maximum amount? Am I optimally actually engaging Krishna service? How much is too much? I mean, if I actually get up for Mangal Arati and then chant 16 rounds and things like that, is it too much? Or how do I understand that? So, right? So we'll actually talk about these things. Without much spending too much time on this, I'm going to go to the first topic, which is about the Ekadashi, right? So some of these things actually are not new for many of you. While I want to give a background around what is Ekadashi a little bit and then go into the Parana time, right? So Ekadashi again is a Vrata, right? So we have something called a Vrata. Vrata really means a vow. Some commitment that you take to fulfill some spiritual goals. It could be even material goals, but basically in the Vedic context, vrata really means a vow. That means I'm committing something. So it has various components in that. A component is basically for what we are going to do it, right? That it should be clear before doing that vrata, number one. Number two, the details of the vrata. What does it all contain? Third, how do I complete this vrata? What are those things that you need to take care and say, if I follow that, that means I followed the vrata fully. And the fourth one is basically exceptions. If there is anything that you do and then you break the vrata in between, what would be the impact that we like to we have to face? So that's called actually a, these are the components of a vrata. Now Ekadashi is also a vrata. And the Ekadashi vrata is actually explained by the Lord himself, mainly in Garuda Purana and Padma Purana. There are a lot of stories around that. I'm not going to get into the stories of why actually Ekadashi came into existence. But it's being practiced. It's a must for all the Vaishnavas. Whoever considers themselves as Vaishnava, as followers of Vishnu, must follow the Ekadashi vrata properly. Now, what is this Ekadashi vrata? Basically, it's kind of a fasting. Upavas. Upavasa means, upa means close by, and vasa means living. So we live near the Lord by chanting and hearing Krishna's names, hearing about Krishna's past names, his devotees' past names. So we hear all these things. By hearing all these things and reducing our food intake, probably we don't cook at all. We just take either fasting completely from even water, or there are various levels of fasting. I'm not going to actually get into the details of the fasting, but some aspect is what I'm going to touch on. If you have questions, you can always ask that. Now, for doing any vrata, you need permission. Women should take permission from their husbands. Normally, anybody for that matter should take a permission of following a vrata from a wise bond, that is a brahmana, a qualified brahmana. If you can't actually take a vrata on your own and do it, unless somebody permits you to do it, you cannot do it. Only a brahmana or the spiritual master can actually allow somebody to do the vrata. And for women, husbands can allow them to do the vrata. If we don't take that kind of permission and do it, the vrata does not actually have any effect on the person who is following. So for us, it's a blanket approval that Srila Prabhupada has already given for women, men, old, young, everyone. Prabhupada said you have to follow Ekadashi, so we follow it. So you don't have to be worried about this aspect. Then there are exceptions. So it is said that when you actually do the Ekadashi Vrata, we are supposed to fast from everything. That means mainly you can take, not even take water, ideally. How does it work? The Ekadashi Vrata is actually for 3 days. The first day, I'll probably talk about it in the next one, but this is about the exception. If you take water, if you take fruits, you take roots, you take milk, is cow's milk preferably, ghee, satisfying a brahmana, a pure brahmana. If a pure brahmana actually gives an order saying that you please do this on this particular day and you do it. For example, if you actually have to eat grains on that particular day, if a pure brahmana tells you it's okay, you eat it, then it is not like breaking Ekadashi. And if a spiritual master tells you for a particular reason, you don't have to follow Ekadashi, it's okay, you can take grain on that day, that is also okay. And then ideally, and ultimately medicine. Because if you are sick, you take some medicine, that medicine doesn't actually, taking that medicine doesn't break the vrata. Right, these are the exceptions which actually has given in the Shastras, in the Hari Bhakti Vilas, these are all actually explained. So who should actually be ideally following this Ekadashi vrata? Anybody between 8 and 80 years. Anybody who's 80 years old should start following the Ekadashi vrata. And then who is up to 80 years, it's what actually is mentioned in the Shastra. There are exceptions because of the health condition. Somebody can actually fast completely, but they can take this water, fruit, root, milk, ghee. These are actually the ones which are mentioned, and satisfying a pure brahmana and following the guru's order. However, sometimes people actually come and tell questions like tomatoes are not allowed, capsicums are not allowed, carrots are not allowed because these are all actually foreign vegetables and things like that. Srila Prabhupada actually used these things in cooking, and then because Prabhupada actually said you all can take it on this particular day of Ekadashi, you follow it because it's following the Guru's order. However, personally, if you want to follow any levels of fasting, you could do that. Okay. Now, this real Ekadashi 100% effect, this is how it works. First day, not the Ekadashi day, the previous day, right, the Dashami day ideally, one can eat only once before sunset on the day fully. Okay. The Ekadashi day is actually a full fast. You don't take even water. Complete fast. The third day, you eat once again. So this is actually the full Ekadashi. That means first day you get 25%, second day you'll get 50%, the third day you get 25%. And on the Ekadashi day, you're supposed to be awake the full day, full night, and then chant the holy name of the Lord, or hear about the Lord's pastimes, or read about the Lord's pastimes. So this is actually the full Ekadashi, which is actually mentioned, that you'll get an effect. However, we in ISKCON, if you can do this way, well and good. If you can't do this way, don't feel bad. But we follow Ekadashi basically to please Guru and Krishna, not to get all this different benefit which is actually coming from Ekadashi. Our mood is to simply satisfy, because Guru is asking us to follow Ekadashi, we follow it. So you can take non-grain on that particular day, and then the next day you need to actually break. On the Dwadasi day, you need to actually pray to the Lord, and if possible, give some charity, worship, and then break the fast. So when you're breaking the fast, means you have to take grain. That means if you have taken a complete nirjal, no water also you have taken, so you drink water by breaking. If you have taken some non-grain, you take grain and then break the fast. So that is actually the process which is actually mentioned in the Shastras. Now, if you want to complete the Ekadashi Vrata, there's something called a Parana time. Parana time really means that time you have to take some grain, saying that I have completed this Vrata of Ekadashi for this time. Now, how is this Parana time calculated? It's normally on the next day of Ekadashi, that is the Dwadasi day. How is this Parana time calculated? Because sometimes it says from 6 a.m. in the morning, 6:03 a.m. to 10:04 a.m. or sometimes you just get 6 a.m. to 8:30 a.m. Something like that, you get a small window for breaking the fast. If you don't break the fast on a particular day, then you following Ekadashi has no meaning. That means Ekadashi will not be counted that you have followed. So you have to be careful that you have to follow the Parana time as per Madhvacharya. Madhvacharya says it's very, very important one understands what is the Parana time properly, and then break the complete the fasting by having grain on that day. Now, there are some complications in this, because sometimes Ekadashi actually comes 2 days after Dashami. After Dashami, there is some Ekadashi, partial Ekadashi, and the Dwadasi day becomes something called a Shuddha Ekadashi. So these are all complications that as normal people, you may not be able to understand, but there's a Vaishnava calendar which says on which day you are supposed to fast. We just simply follow that, because as long as you follow a calendar which is actually given by the system, it should be good. We don't have to be worried about it. Now, understanding this Parana time, how does this work? So I'm going to actually take a very, very, a simple example for us to understand how is this calculated. The Ekadashi day, say the sunrise is at 5 a.m. in the morning. The Dwadasi day, assume that the 5 a.m. is the same time that sunrise on the Dwadasi. So, and you imagine that the next day, the first portion of the next day is considered as the Harivasara. So Harivasara is the period wherein you are supposed to actually take a bath and then worship the Lord. Basically, every Ekadashi actually has a particular deity actually is mentioned. You worship the deity of the Lord, Govindiji or Krishna's different form. You worship the Lord by offering flowers, tulsi leaves, and then chanting, and then doing your Mangalarati program. When you do that, that's called Harivasara. Now, after Harivasara, you get some time to break the fast. You actually break the whole Ekadashi. That's saying that I've completed the Ekadashi. Now, whatever benefit I'm getting out of this particular Vrata, you can ask the Lord whatever you want to do with that. Normally, the devotees, what they do is they pray for the well-being of the spiritual master or their own, please remove my anarthas, whatever I have, and things like that. You can pray for anything you want on the Dwadasi day before breaking the fast. Now, I'm going to give you a very practical example of how this Parana time is calculated. Ekadashi is first day. The 25% of the Dwadasi day, that is the Tithi day, is called Harivasara. After that, you break. And the break time is actually 1/3 of the remaining time. So let me take an example. It'll be easy for us. Okay, today 5 a.m. is sunrise. That is today's Ekadashi. I follow Ekadashi today, and tomorrow 5 a.m. is sunrise. There is no change in the Tithi. So because of that, the next day, Dwadasi day, the sunset is 5 p.m. Okay, so you have 12 hours approximately for Dwadasi. Correct? So 5 a.m. to 5 p.m. of tomorrow is actually Dwadasi. Now, 25% of that is 3 hours, right? 12 hours, 25% is 3 hours. The 3 hours you added to your Ekadashi. That means, which is called Harivasara, that means 5 a.m. for tomorrow plus 3 hours you add. That becomes 8 a.m. So the 8 a.m. will be your start time of Ekadashi break. How much time we have? 1/3 of that whole thing. Remaining is actually 9 hours, right? So 3 hours already gone for Hariwasara. You have 9 hours left out. 1/3 of the time is 3 hours. So your breakfast time would be 8 a.m. to 11 a.m. This is how the Paran time is actually calculated for Ekadashi. Now, there are very, very big complications because if Tithi changes, if today is Ekadashi and tomorrow also is Ekadashi at 5 a.m., then it becomes quite complicated to break. So what they do is they do something called Shuddha Ekadashi. That means on the Dwadashi day, they actually do the fasting. On the Trayodashi day, they actually do the break. So these are all actually calculated in the calendar. So we don't have to be worried, but this is how Paran time actually works. Is that okay? So this all is Paran time. So you have to break grain on with grains on during the Paran time. So this time, 8 a.m. to 11 a.m. is what is actually mentioned in the calendar. Okay. Okay, so I'll move on. If you don't have any questions on Ekadashi, I'll move on to the next topic because this is just more like a technical detail, but we should be aware of how it is actually being followed. That's all it is. If you guys don't have any, if the team doesn't have any questions, I will actually move on to the next topic, which is a little important on the...
Prabhu. Hare Krishna.
Yes.
Prabhu, this one, in Ekadashi, like we all know many times, like somebody will not have water also. Hmm. Somebody have some prasadam also and somebody will not have water and some prasadam.
Yeah.
So, which one is the best Prabhu, like for us for improve fast?
So, it all depends on your health, Aparajit Prabhu. It's a good question. So, don't imitate. Just because somebody is actually following very strict Ekadashi, they are not actually taking anything. They will progress faster than you. Possibly, yes. Ideally speaking, first day, you actually take only once a meal. On the Ekadashi day, full fasting without water. The next day, actually bake with water, but eat only once on the second day, that is Dwadashi day also. You follow all these things together, then you get 100% benefit for the Ekadashi mentioned in the Shastras. But your health also has to be checked. Don't imitate others. You see what is possible for you to follow. The real important thing is Hariwasara. And the important thing is Upavas, but means staying closer to Krishna. If you can actually fast and then do your devotion service better without eating anything, if you can actually chant Hare Krishna more rounds and chant more rounds or read Prabhupada's books or do some preaching program, something without eating, do that. But if you can actually do that with eating Ekadashi Prasadam, please do that. The point is not actually all these things. The point is to be engaged in Krishna service. That is what actually Prabhupada taught us. That is why we do something called Ekadashi feast. We'll have more items on Ekadashi day than other days. Just to actually motivate people. But you have to follow Ekadashi. Do whatever actually is convenient for you so that you will be able to follow Ekadashi and also remember Krishna. It should not be a case, oh, okay, Ekadashi is again coming, man. I don't want to actually follow this. That should not be the mentality. So do whatever is necessary so that you'll be able to follow Ekadashi plus also engage in Krishna service. That is actually the important thing, Abhyaji Prabhu.
Okay, Prabhu. Thank you.
What is the question?
Hare Krishna Prabhuji.
Yes.
Prabhuji, Dandat Pranam Prabhuji. Prabhuji, if someone dies in the family on the Ekadashi day, so how they have to follow, could you explain, Prabhuji? The Tithi and all, they cannot follow.
So right? On the Ekadashi day, if somebody dies, how do you actually, do you follow, right? So the Shastra actually mentioned, Srimad Bhagavatam mentions, there is actually in the 7th canto, there are explanation given on that, Mataji. The explanation is that Narada Muni explains on the Ekadashi day, we don't offer grains to the demigods. We fast on Ekadashi and then we move that particular Tithi to the Dwadashi and do everything on the Dwadashi day. However, if people are not devotees in your family, they will object to all these things. Let them actually continue to do whatever they are doing on the Ekadashi day, but you people follow Ekadashi on your own. Does it help? Say if somebody actually, okay. What I'm saying is, if somebody actually dies on the Ekadashi day, and in your family, all of them are devotees of the Lord, they can understand these things, then please follow the rituals on the Dwadashi day, not on the Ekadashi day. However, if nobody else is there is a devotee and they say no, Ekadashi day only we will do it, and then let them do it. But you people don't follow the grain and things like that. You follow the Ekadashi prasad for taking and things like that, and keep chanting Hare Krishna. That's all I would say.
Okay,
Okay. It's possible this kind of situations will and because otherwise you'll fight with the family and there'll be more complicated things for you to solve. So don't take it like that.
Yes, okay.
So I see there's a question. Can you please explain briefly again about the exceptions? Is that to be applied based on health reasons? Yes, Sunil Prabhu. The importance is basically those are those exceptions which are actually given. If you see, let me actually go back. The exception given is water, fruits, root, milk, ghee. These are all actually based on health concerns or service. If there is some service that needs to be done and then you actually don't take anything and you're sitting in like a vegetable at the corner of the room and not doing the seva, then the spiritual master might tell you at least take something and do the seva, because the service to Krishna is more important than all these rituals. The rituals are important, but not at the cost of the service to or the service to Krishna. If Guru tells you to do something, that's actually more important than all these things. For doing that, these are actually given as a exception for us.
Haribol Prabhu, I have a question. Yep. So as part of the vritta, like I've heard somewhere that you should avoid traveling also.
Hmm.
Right? Like you know, either train or bus or whatever, right?
Yeah.
So, can you briefly? So, as part of the vritta, food diet is one. Can you briefly touch upon what else is like? For example, you cannot cut your hair, cannot cut your nails. Can you briefly touch upon that?
Okay. So, I mean, see, there are various reasons like this, which are exceptions given on Ekadashi day. We don't actually increase our body needs, right? Doing facials and cutting your hair and things like that. But Prabhupada personally did not follow that so strictly, because Prabhupada said if there is a preaching engagement, you should actually clean shave yourself and then go and attend the program rather than actually be shabbily dressed and then going through that. Service is more important than all these things. But ideally, if you are not doing any of these things on those days, cutting nails and then shaving or having a haircut and things like that, is supposed to be avoided on Ekadashi day, only because of the reason that on that day at least remember more about Krishna and not about your body. Right, but again, these are all more details, Arun Prabhu. It's not that one must not do. If you do that, it is an offense and things like that. No, it all depends on the situation that you are in right now. If it's required that you actually have a presentation in the office, you need to be clean shaven. You need to actually be properly groomed. Please groom yourself and go for that. That's what it says. And then the traveling part, actually, it's mentioned because it's difficult. Actually, if you are traveling in the olden days, it's very difficult to get proper food and things like that. Even now, it's not easy. And then if you're tired, if you go to the hospital, they may give you some kind of medicine or whatever it is, and you will have to break the Ekadashi. So that's the reason normally on Ekadashi day, they don't allow, or normally they don't travel. But it's not actually something which is must be followed like that. It's okay. But if you can avoid on Ekadashi day, because personally, I've tried this on Ekadashi day. I was traveling to the US. The problem was, it was so cold in the flight. I mean, I actually took fruits and roots and then tried it. You don't get any good hot food. I had terrible headache on that day. So it was very tough. So that's kind of reason actually. I mean, even people say when you actually shave, there is a cut. If you don't take grains, it will not heal easily. So that's the reason they say don't shave and things like that. That's more like speculation, I would say. It's some of the modern doctors tell me like that if you fast on the day, it is not actually good for shaving and things like that. But shastrically, this is what is mentioned around Prabhu. Two more questions. Okay, I somehow not able to see the questions here. Let me see. Is somebody
okay. I can read it, Prabhu. So
can you read, Prabhu? Yeah,
yes, Prabhu. So Rohini Mataji is asking that Hare Krishna Prabhuji. Because of some reason, if we are not able to break the fast on parent time, then what should we do?
See, it's as important as actually, following the Ekadashi. One must be aware of this condition and there is no exceptions given. One must actually break the fast. I'll remember this story of Maharaj Ambarish, which is there in Srimad Bhagavatam. Ambarish Maharaj was actually put into that kind of situation wherein he had to break the fast for parent time. And Durvasa Muni did not want him to break, because by following that vrata, end of that vrata, if he actually doesn't complete the vrata, you will not get the benefit. So Durvasa Muni wanted to test him. He took Charanamrita and broke the fast like that. It is very important. Don't have exception. If you can follow Ekadashi, definitely you can follow the Parantime. no exceptions. Parantime, I don't think it's a big problem. You have enough 2 hours, 3 hours. You just have to take one grain of rice and break it. Or any, even a biscuit is fine if you don't have anything else. But you have to take some grain and then break the fast. That actually closes the Ekadashi Vrata. Okay. Yeah, Prabhu.
Madhavi Mataji is checking that is Jagran necessary on Ekadashi day?
Yeah, so Jagran means basically being awake in the night. If possible, yes. I know in Mayapur and other places, in the temple actually, they do a night, full night kirtan. They do something called a sandhya bhajan. They come, they chant the whole night actually. There are devotees who are actually there who actually do that. It may not be practically possible for everyone, but at least in mentally, we should be prepared. Someday in my life, when I become older, at least I should follow these things more seriously. End of the day, it'll actually help you prove that you're not this body. You can still survive. You'll become more detached from this body. So it helps, but don't imitate right now. Yeah, that's all I would say.
Prabhuji, can we break that in with water in Parantime or only with grains only?
If you're fasted, if you are done nirjal fast, that means you're not taking water at all on the first day, then you break with water on the next day. But if you've eaten some fruits and things like that, you must break it with grain on the next day. Between that time. The Parantime is very important. One has to actually be, one has to remember the Parantime. That is the reason actually that the devotees post that the details of the Parantime. What is the time to break the fast? So take it seriously. See, many times we don't follow all those things seriously. That is why we don't get the benefit. If you follow Ekadashi very strictly, without having any grain on that particular day and then next day do it, within 6 months, 99% of all your karma will get burnt off and you will never actually have sufferings.
I was not following this Parantime only. I was not following till now from last 2 years.
You will not get the benefit. You will not get the benefit of following the Ekadashi. You will get purified very fast. And whatever you are going to ask the Lord after the Parantime is done, I mean basically during the breaking time, it will happen. It's just a matter of time. Because I have practical experience of that. So please follow it carefully. Parantime is very important.
Don't take it lightly.
And no problem. Sanatan Prabhu has a question that what happened when we are traveling across the time zones during Parantime?
Okay, so that is why actually that's a good question. So that is why actually the travel is normally avoided if you are going from one place to another place. What you can really do is whichever place actually has the maximum number of time you spend, you follow Ekadashi in that time, that zone.
Okay, Prabhu. So I think because we have around 54 devotees, so we have a lot of questions, but I think we can move on to next topic now.
Okay. Sure. So this is very important. So devotees, please follow Ekadashi carefully because it pleases Krishna so much. And also follow the next day, which is actually the Ekadashi Vrata breaking, which is actually the Parantime. Harivasara, if you can do best, but if you're not able to do it because you're not able to get up early in the morning and then do the Mangala Arati and things like that, it is still okay, but aspire to come to that stage someday. Yeah. Okay, so the next one is also pretty important because I know sometimes we have, I hope actually there's nobody new here, Gaurav Prabhu, because this is actually a pretty sensitive topic because we need to know these things. There's something called Guru Parampara. We have Srila Prabhupada, his disciples, and then before that, the entire Brahma Madhva Gaudiya Sampradaya is there we have. So if we follow these principles carefully, then we get the complete benefit. If we don't follow, we get the benefit, but not the complete benefit, right? So we'll try to understand what it really means. I'm going to talk about Guru. This is actually aspect of Guru, since you all completed, some of you have completed the session on Guru sometime back. I think Gaurav Prabhu, your group has already completed the session on Guru, right?
Yes, Prabhu.
Okay, so they will actually be able to understand it a little better, but I'll still cover about what are these guru and things like that. What do you mean by guru and things like that? So the first aspect about this is, we might have heard about in, at least in Bangalore, there's something called Ritvikism. Ritvikism really means that people say that Srila Prabhupada, who's our founder Acharya, is the only guru and nobody else can be really a guru. In definition, Ritvik really means an officiating priest of any yajna. That means I am the Mukhya Yajaman. I'm doing a yajna. So I am sponsoring the yajna. I am the owner of the yajna. I have a priest actually offering the mantras, everything, and into the fire. So who is going to get the benefit? I am going to get the benefit because I am the one who is doing the yajna. But who is actually conducting the yajna? The priest is conducting the yajna for me. Sometimes you have Satyanarayan Puja, anything for that matter, like you actually invite somebody and somebody does the fire yajna in front of you. They are doing it for you. You are actually the real yajaman. You are actually the benefactor of the pati yajna. But what are that person? That person is called a Ritvik. That person is actually nominated by you to do the yajna or homa, whatever you call, for your benefit. So that's actually called an officiating priest, Ritvik. Now, the Ritvik philosophy, I'll come to that. But before that, I want to make you all understand what are the type of gurus we have. There are three types of gurus. One is called Vartma Pradarshika Guru. Second is called Siksha Guru. And third is called a Diksha Guru. And based on this, there are many modern terminologies like mentors, counselors, Bhaktivedanta leaders, and things like that. These are all just names, basically. But in Sanskrit and in the Shastra, these three types of gurus actually are mentioned. Vartama Pradarshaka Guru really means someone who brings you to Krishna consciousness. Someone who actually shows you the path. Okay, this is actually nice path, please, why don't you come to the temple? Why don't you attend the Bhakti Viksha program? Or somebody gives you a book of Krishna and then you read that book. That person is called Vartama Pradarshaka Guru because he just showed the right direction to you. We respect them. Then there is a Siksha Guru. Siksha Guru really means, Siksha really means instruction. Siksha Guru is a person who actually gives you instructions, a lot of instructions. Now I am also talking, but am I a Siksha Guru? No, I'm not that kind of Siksha Guru. Siksha Guru is actually a very heavy word. Someone who is actually connected to the Lord very clearly actually in the parampara, and he or she can actually give instructions, and if you follow those instructions, it's as good as Krishna giving you the instruction. This is called a Siksha Guru. And there's a Diksha Guru. Diksha Guru really means someone who is initiating you into the path of Krishna consciousness. Vartama Pradarshaka Guru is showing the direction towards the right path. So Diksha Guru is someone who is actually initiating you, saying that for this life, you are going to follow these principles and then these instructions till you die. So that's called a Diksha Guru. So all these three gurus are equally important in delivering the conditioned soul like us towards Krishna. While Vartama Pradarshaka Guru, we actually respect them because they actually have done the right thing for us in our life. We don't worship them. A Siksha Guru and Diksha Guru are very, very important. Diksha Guru is extremely important. We actually worship them as good as Krishna. And a Siksha Guru, we worship them, but not as important as a Diksha Guru. Diksha Guru is very, very more important because Diksha Guru takes responsibility of delivering us to Krishna. If you make a mistake, the Siksha Guru is supposed to train us. A Diksha Guru will take responsibility. How do I actually give you an example? If you are asked to do something, say I'm supposed to go and then preach in say some very low class place, some places in the world where actually it's not easy to give Krishna consciousness to anybody, and then you get killed in that place, or you break the principles, you're not able to actually follow the four regulative principles. A Siksha Guru has no, what you call, there is nothing binding that person. They have told you, follow these four regulative principles, fine. A Diksha Guru, if they tell you, okay, please follow the four regulative principles, and you are taken the service of going and preaching in those kind of places, and you break the regulative principles, what really happens there is the Diksha Guru will get affected, not you. Because you are following their instructions, and because you are following the instructions, and then sometimes you get disturbed, or you get attacked by wrong things, Diksha Guru will be taking the responsibility. That is why Diksha Guru is worshipped as good as Krishna himself. Right? Now, Diksha means initiation. Now, this Ritvikism is something like that. So we have various, Vartama Pradarshaka Guru could be anybody. It could be your father, it could be your mother, it could be a son, it could be a friend, it could be anybody who is actually giving you the first taste of Krishna consciousness. A Siksha Guru is a person who is actually giving instructions. You are hearing their lectures regularly. They're all actually Siksha Gurus in some level. A spiritual master, a sannyasi, is normally a Siksha Guru. Now, for all of us, Srila Prabhupada is actually a Siksha Guru because he's given us his books, which actually is giving us a direction towards going to Krishna. Now, a Diksha Guru is someone who actually sits in front of the fire and makes you promise that I'm going to follow the four regulative principles, and I also chant Hare Krishna 16 rounds every day without fail, and also try to help the person in the mission of Srila Prabhupada. That's a Diksha Guru. Now, the Ritvikism says that Srila Prabhupada is the only Diksha Guru and no other Guru can initiate disciples. So this is actually the deviation which is actually introduced in the system. Now in the Guru Parampara, we actually have various Diksha Gurus. But for all of us, Srila Prabhupada is also a Siksha Guru, but he's not a Diksha Guru for us because we have not met him. For all of us, we have never met Srila Prabhupada in person, so he can't be our Diksha Guru. So this is a deviation that some of the temples in ISKCON follow, saying that only Srila Prabhupada can initiate. This is actually a kind of deviation. We have to be very careful in following this. I would say not following this, right? Don't follow blindly, because actually is it completely wrong? It is improper, I would say. What would we lose if we follow this pattern? We'll actually talk about that a little bit, right? And our parampara is actually a siksha parampara. They are not diksha parampara. That means like, for example, Narada Muni instructing Vyasadev is instructing Arjuna or anybody else. Like, there are a lot of other followers which are there in the parampara, like Madhvacharya, and then coming into Brahma Madhva Gaura Sampradaya, we have Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, and then six Goswamis, then Srila Prabhupada's disciples. All of them give siksha. Not necessarily all of them are initiated by their previous acharyas, but they follow the principles. Now, we follow Srila Prabhupada as a siksha guru because he has given us all the information what is required for us to progress. But Srila Prabhupada is not actually the Diksha Guru for all of us. He is actually only the Siksha Guru for all of us. We have our own Siksha Guru. We need to actually follow certain people, certain disciples of Srila Prabhupada, and take guidance from them. So they are actually the Diksha Guru for us. Now, this group, which actually follows the Ritvikism, is actually taking a very theoretical based approach. They have not asked Prabhupada as a directly that, Is the Ritvikism correct path or anything? No, because it's never followed in the past. In the past, nobody actually follows the Ritvikism. It just came very recently, maybe about 20 years, something like that. and then this, I don't think you all have to get into the details of it. Just have an awareness about this. If somebody has specific questions, I can always answer that. But for practical sake, understand that this group follows Srila Prabhupada is the only Diksha Guru, and you can get initiated by Srila Prabhupada directly. So we should avoid it. We should not actually follow that. So if you follow this, what will happen? We know that actually there are various steps in Krishna consciousness. We can go on Ado Shraddha Bhajana Tata Sadhu Sangha Bhajana Kriya, like that. There is something called a Bhava Bhakti. Bhava Bhakti means you start getting emotional attachment to Krishna. That means you start loving Krishna so much that you can't live without thinking of Krishna. That's called Bhava Bhakti. One can actually make progress till Bhava Bhakti. But to get our original position, a personal guru has to actually train us. He has to actually reveal what it is, what is our role in the spiritual world. We came from Vaikuntha. When we get back to Vaikuntha, what is our activity there? That has to be taught by the guru. That you will not get if you follow this system of Ritvikism. Is there any questions on this so far? It's a pretty loaded thing. Not many people know about it, Gaurav Prabhu. But
So there are two questions.
Okay.
One is from Anshuman Prabhuji. He's checking that Hare Krishna, now how can anyone want to take Diksha, then how that can be done? Like if someone wants to take Diksha, how that can be done? And Meera Mataji is checking that why deviation is being allowed, as it gets confusing to differentiate by name of temple. In such case, should ISKCON not prevent the deviated temple from your not using the ISKCON name?
Okay, good point. So the first question is basically, how do we actually see? Understand, it is mentioned through Krishna, we get a guru basically. Because when you actually start praying to Krishna, saying that, my Lord, I want to come back to you, please guide me. If you sincerely pray to Krishna, Krishna will actually send us a guru. The guru will actually see us. That's why the guru is called a seer. He is the person who can actually identify us. We cannot identify the guru so easily. We should actually simply pray to Krishna. And when you start praying to Krishna, Krishna will actually put you into touch with the right person who can actually give you the instruction and then guide you back to Krishna. So through guru, we get Krishna. Through Krishna, we get guru. And through guru, we get Krishna back. So that's actually the the instruction which is mentioned in the Shastras. For now, chant 16 rounds of Hare Krishna and then follow the four regulative principles and read Srila Prabhupada books. Very soon, if you actually keep doing this and praying to Krishna, that my Lord, I want to actually come back to you, please guide me, you will start getting information about the Guru. So you don't have to be worried about it. The Guru will find you. That's always been the case in the scriptures. And Dhruva Maharaj wanted to actually see the Lord. Lord sent Narada Muni to him. Prahlad Maharaj, the same case. So you will always find the Guru actually coming in, searching out where you are, and somehow you will actually get connected to the Guru. So you don't have to be worried. Be in touch with these devotees. The devotees will actually reveal it to you. So very soon. Okay, so on the second question about this deviation, yes, it's a very, very big situation that we have, Meera Mataji. ISKCON is like a government, right? It's not so easy to actually change things overnight because everyone is a devotee, but then everyone has their sometimes misunderstanding and things like that. There are legal cases running right now on those things, which we should not be so much worried about. But that's a very, very reason one should actually be in touch with some authority and then take their guidance. And as long as you are sincere and Krishna is there in your heart, he will guide you to the right direction. If you actually want to get cheated, you can always get cheated, right? So hopefully things will change. I actually keep calling this, I always call this out. ISKCON is like a gold mine. You can get gold, you can also get ordinary earth, because gold actually stays inside the earth, right? So they have to excavate the gold ore. But if you're actually looking for Krishna, you will get Krishna. But if you're looking for all this gossip and then all these different things, you'll always get that very easily. So you might get actually carried away. So depend on Krishna, because he's there in your heart as Paramatma. And then you're already connected to this group. You have under the guidance of Gaurav Prabhu and Pransiti Mataji and many other devotees. So be in touch with them. They will actually guide you to the right path. So if you have any questions, you can always reach out to us and then get clarification. So don't, just because there are big temples, don't think that all temples actually are talking the same thing. Part of Kali Yuga, it is actually. Kali Yuga is meant for hypocrisy. So there are so many deviations which can really come. And you can get carried away by all these things. Don't look into that direction at all. Hopefully Krishna will actually settle these things quickly, but it's not easy.
Babuji, so for a neophyte, right? How would you differentiate? So a person is going and telling them, please come to class, you know, please read the books.
Yeah.
So he doesn't have enough knowledge to see if it is as it is or Ritvik system, right?
Yeah.
So there is very high likely chance that he might fall in the wrong hands, because I've seen that happen in Malleshwaram, right?
Yeah.
So, I mean, is there anything we can do about this? Because like Prabhupada says, milk touched by the snake, right?
Yeah.
So what can we do from a practical standpoint? Right? Because when we go for book distribution, they say, "Ella ide, already we have."
Yeah. Right?
Because there, if you pay annual fee, you can get everything as part of the deal, right? So is there anything we can do practically to kind of tell them this message?
Okay, so see, worshipping Srila Prabhupada directly as a Diksha Guru is like worshipping Hanumanji. Okay, there's nothing which can stop us from worshipping Hanumanji, and there's nothing wrong also to worship Hanumanji. If you actually really sincerely worship Srila Prabhupada, someday actually Prabhupada himself will actually guide you to the right path, but it'll just get delayed, that's all. So they are not actually, see, as long as you don't break the regulative principles and then you don't offend Vaishnavas, you are in the right path. If you go like that, see, I mean, this is all the Lord's plan, definitely. If you see, anybody here wants to be like Duryodhan? I'm just asking this question simply, right? None of us want to be like Duryodhan. But if Duryodhan was not there, you would never know what is the glories of the Pandavas. Pandavas' glories wouldn't have been known. So Lord has a plan, I mean, because without his sanction, nothing can really happen. So we have to actually have patience and then, take it in the right spirit, basically. Even if they actually go under the guidance of those kind of people, it's not completely wrong as such. It's just that they should be careful not to commit Vaishnava Aparad. When I say Vaishnava Aparad, considering Srila Prabhupada is my spiritual master, it's not wrong. But considering others actually are completely unqualified, they're actually useless people and things like that, that's very offensive. Krishna himself does not like this. In fact, Prabhupada himself does not like this. Prabhupada says, if you like me, you should like my disciples, right? So we should actually have that kind of faith that, okay, I want to accept Prabhupada as my guru. It's okay. There's nothing wrong in that as such in the beginning. But don't offend his disciples. That's very important. Yeah, Arun Prabhu, that's all I would say at this point in time. So the answer that you can really give is, if they are neophyte devotees, ask them to chant Hare Krishna and follow Prabhupada's instructions in the books. When they actually grow up, when they actually start asking Krishna, talking to Krishna, he's asking prayers, I mean doing prayers and then asking Krishna for help, the Lord will actually, in the heart, will actually guide them to the right way. So otherwise these things will come, these things will go. There are so many other things which are there, which is always there for us to actually get deviated.
Thank you, Prabhu.
Yeah. Okay. So, yes.
There are other questions as well. So, Shiv Kumar Prabhu is checking that if Ritvik is not good, then why it is followed?
Yeah. So, see, I would say it's like just like I'm following Jesus Christ. Okay. Is there anything wrong in following Jesus Christ? I will still go Sunday. I will go and then I'll do whatever crap I want on other days. And Sunday, I'll go and then say, I'm sorry, like that. I can do the same with Prabhupada also. So there is actually a difference between accepting a personal guru. When you actually have a personal guru, when you talk to that person, the person can catch hold of your ears and then completely, what do you call, correct you in the sense like what you are doing is completely wrong. Prabhupada will not come and correct you like that. I mean, he might actually come in dreams. People say, Prabhupada is coming in dreams and telling me and things like that. It's all fine, but then it doesn't happen always. It could be your just hallucination. You're doing that. So the parampara actually works through the disciplic succession. One has to actually have a guru whom you can actually serve. The Srinadapi Sunichana Tarorapi Sarishana will come only if you actually surrender to a person. You at least have to have one person whom you actually are going to listen to and not argue with that person. So that is actually the Diksha Guru. Because Prabhupada doesn't interact with you. So it's not easy to actually do that. And that's not actually the way. If that was the way, why Prabhupada, why don't you take Bhaktisiddhanta Thakur, who is actually a master of all these spiritual masters? Why Bhaktisiddhanta Thakur? Why not Lord Chaitanya, who is Krishna himself? And he's so merciful he is. You can always use the logic to go back. So this keeps happening all the time. Because Prabhupada disciples, when Prabhupada was there, came to know that his godbrothers, that is Prabhupada's godbrothers, were far more advanced because Prabhupada was a grihastha before. He was not a born sannyasi. He was married. So they felt there are many Prabhupada's disciples, I mean godbrothers, who are actually sannyasis from beginning. So let us actually go and take their advice and guidance. It's all deviation. We should not actually follow this. So we have to be careful actually. It's not that good, but somewhere it is actually introduced in between. Since they are also doing some seva in the service of the Lord, Krishna will accept it. I mean, because that's also required. Maybe for us to actually, because Prabhupada mentioned that for the next 10,000 years, these are the basis. So we are learning from our mistakes. There are some mistakes that devotees have done because of lack of guidance or immaturity. So they will learn. And then as you go on, become very, very strict in following that. Yeah. People follow it basically because I will ask you this question, which is better? Srimad Bhagavatam is better or a person who is following Bhagavatam is better? It's easy to say that Srimad Bhagavatam is better because Bhagavatam doesn't have any mistakes. People can make mistakes. A person can make mistakes. Right? So if you do that way, then we should actually follow the Bhagavatam. Then why actually have a guru at all in the first place? But why do we need guru? Someone has to actually correct us in the right path. Someone has to actually catch hold of our ears and say, what you have done is wrong. Please don't do it. Come back in the right track. Someone has to do that. Someone has to sit and then pray for us. Someone has to actually take some kind of ownership on us. So for that, we need to actually have some person, guru, who you can follow, who can see. Bhagavatam gives example about Draupadi. Can any lady here or any gentleman actually go through the difficulties Draupadi went through? Impossible for us. Even thinking about that is very difficult. So we have to actually be very careful in these things. The philosophy will be there. I mean, there are even after Lord Chaitanya left, there are so many upper sampradayas which is saying that Lord Chaitanya is Krishna himself, but Nityananda Prabhu is not very important. So they follow only Lord Chaitanya. So that is not advised. All Panchatattva are very important for us to follow. So Shukumar Prabhu, I would say the Ritvikism is being practiced quite a bit because we know that we all respect Srila Prabhupada as the Param Guru, he's the Param Vaishnava, we all know that. So between that person and someone whom in my eyes sees that, okay, this person is not like on Prabhupada caliber, I will naturally go to Prabhupada and say that I will take the initiation of Prabhupada. That is why Ritvikism many people follow. Many people means very few people follow, not so many people. But someone who is very fortunate would actually accept somebody who is actually a disciple of Prabhupada or a grand disciple of Prabhupada, whoever it is in the Parampara system. And then we still follow Prabhupada's instructions. We don't actually deviate from whatever Prabhupada is saying. We really try to follow that. But we follow looking at someone who's following. It's like that. Yeah.
Yeah. So we have another question from Komal Mataji. She's saying that our Diksha Guru should be Uttam Adhikari, means who can never fall down in a spiritual life.
Yeah.
Then why maximum of these Ritviks fall down from their spiritual path?
Okay. So not maximum. I mean, I would say in the beginning, actually, there are a few devotees who had made mistakes. Remember, actually, these are all kids, actually, from our estimation. They're all 24, 25 years. Many of them actually had no clue about what life is. They thought, okay, Srila Prabhupada is doing like that, I should just imitate like that. And then they couldn't. I mean, how many of us actually get up for Mangala Arati every day? So if you do these things for every day, it is so difficult. And they made mistakes. They imitated Srila Prabhupada. And then they accepted the spiritual master. They became spiritual master and they thought this is how it is. So it's kingly kind of lifestyle and things like that. It really affected them. They couldn't actually continue like that. So it's a lifetime commitment. They didn't do it. And they fell off. They actually fell off. I mean, they fell from their standard. Anyways, we are all fallen in this world. I mean, who is more, who is less, it's all just relative. They did mistakes, and because of that, they all actually fell down to a lower level of serving Krishna. Now, if somebody actually had accepted them as their Diksha Guru, that's a kind of mistake. Now, what about these people? They really make a mistake where they're actually completely wrong? No, maybe actually the Lord has a different plan. The Lord actually would have what you call exposed. Somebody has to take some kind of role. See, surrender to Krishna really means that whatever Krishna puts us in any condition, we should be actually happy to accept it and then be subservient to the Lord. So that's actually the real surrender. These devotees who actually surrendered, maybe actually they understood that's a mistake and then they actually connected themselves with another person. Now, actually, if you see today's world, actually, the GBs actually learned all these things. So these are actually very technical details, Komal Mataji. It's not actually something which is very easily explained for a common public. But understand that these are all kids at point in time. There are details which actually I can share. But then just to give you an example about when Srila Prabhupada left the body, he went back to Godhead. His disciples did not know what to do. There were so many disciples waiting, devotees waiting for initiation. So they had known from Srila Prabhupada that if I am no longer in this planet, please ask Bhaktivedanta Narayan Maharaj. So they went and asked Narayan Maharaj. These 11 people went and asked Narayan Maharaj. So what should we do? He said, you actually initiate all of them. So they took zones. They divided everything into zones and they started initiating without clearly understanding what they are supposed to do. What's a Diksha Guru? They did not know all these things. It takes some time. It takes, Prabhupada says 20 years, it takes minimum for someone to actually get maturity in Krishna consciousness. Then you can actually understand, okay, what has to be done, what should not be done. They have no clue. I mean, devotees actually, they came in 1969, 1970, they got first initiation, 71, they got second initiation, 73, they are sannyas initiated. 4 years. We struggled 10 years, stand 16 rounds of Hare Krishna mantra, and they are sannyas initiated. So definitely they made mistakes in the past, but we should understand that we should not blame them for that, because at that point in time, they had no clue. They had no guidance. They didn't know. They didn't tell anyone. Now they have learned everything. Now they don't make mistakes. Now you don't find so many, people actually falling off from the system. It happened in the past, which is actually a wrong thing. It should not happen. It's for learning. If you have any specific questions, you can actually always write to me, because it may not be required for everyone to understand these things. That's what I would say. Yes, Gaurav Prabhu.
So Meera Mataji is saying that she's receiving message for their Gita classes as well. And because she get confused that whether it is bona fide in Parampara, so she accidentally has forwarded to other groups as well, and then later she understood that this is a deviated group.
Yeah, the most important thing in this, either we follow the Parampara system or we follow the Prabhupada, the Ritvikism system, is that the philosophy is still the same. We still follow Prabhupada books. There's no difference. We should not commit any Vaishnava aparad. Yeah, that's very, very, very important. Normally, the Ritvikism followers actually will commit a big Vaishnava aparad, saying that all these sannyasis are all crazy. They are actually not allowed by Prabhupada to initiate. And so many other things they say. These devotees actually have taken sannyas before, even before we are born in this world. They are far more, whatever certain, than even if they are correct or wrong, they are in a different dimension altogether. We should be very careful not to actually criticize them. That is the only mistake they make. If they don't criticize, they are in the right direction, because Prabhupada will actually allow them to come into a right direction later. But if they start criticizing devotees, saying that what they have done is wrong, they are all not nice and things like that, that's big Vaishnava aparad. And if they do Vaishnava aparad, they can't go back to Godhead. Yeah, just avoid, better to actually avoid, because you get confused about all these things. And every place you actually have these kind of deviations, and this is one of them. Yeah, like that. Okay, if you actually have a specific question, I'll take it later. I'll move on, because we have actually a very interesting month which is actually coming. It's called the Bhadra Purnima, month of Bhadra. So it's mentioned in the Bhadra month, if somebody actually donates the Srimad Bhagavatam as a gift to somebody who is qualified to read that, on the Purnima day, basically the Bhadra Purnima day, or any other day, it's fine still. It's basically the moon, the full moon day, which is again, I think, on the September 2nd this year. If somebody actually gives Bhagavatam to others, they actually get the chance of going to the spiritual world. So that is actually mentioned in the Shastra. This is actually in Srimad Bhagavatam 12th canto, which is about the glories of the Srimad Bhagavatam itself. So we are getting this opportunity to actually distribute Srimad Bhagavatam. Either you can gift ourselves, we could actually buy it for our own reading, because Srimad Bhagavatam actually has every answer that you can ever think of. There is actually, we should actually be questioning this, because we always want to talk to God, if God is available, right? When Kali Yuga started, this age actually started 5,000 years back about that time. It was very clear there were so many confusions, and then the sages actually mentioned this. If you see the shloka down, this is actually the answer which is actually given by the sages of Naimisharanya. This Bhagavata Purana is as brilliant as the sun. It has arisen just after the departure of Lord Krishna, who is one abode, accompanied by religion, knowledge, etc. Persons who have lost their vision due to the dense darkness of ignorance in the age of Kali shall get light from this Purana. This is actually mentioned in the beginning of Srimad Bhagavatam, saying that every question that we have, answer is there in Srimad Bhagavatam. But of course, we have to actually take guidance from the Acharyas to understand the meaning of what it really means. But that important the Srimad Bhagavatam is. The more Srimad Bhagavatam we actually have in houses, the more auspiciousness will actually be created in the world. It is also mentioned in many other places that where Srimad Bhagavatam is there, the demigods actually reside in that place, because Srimad Bhagavatam is Krishna himself. Since Srimad Bhagavatam is Krishna himself, when Srimad Bhagavatam is there at home, you worship, you keep it in a place and you read every day. One, you get the knowledge about whatever Krishna wants to communicate to you. Second, the demigods stay there. When the demigods stay there, there's nothing evil which is going to stay in that place. All of them actually go away, because the demigods are very powerful and they drive away all evilness in the house. There's more prosperity, the more auspiciousness is actually created. And more of these book sets actually are distributed in the world will actually become more auspicious. So this is an opportunity that we are going to get for this whole month to distribute Srimad Bhagavatam in any language. I think we have in various languages. Could be any of the South Indian language, North Indian languages, or even in English. The English version alone is actually translated by Srila Prabhupada. So take this opportunity, and then I think you'll start getting more information about this very, very soon in the group. So if you have any questions, you can always ask. We should understand one thing. When Srila Prabhupada also traveled to the US on the Bhadra Purnima day, he entered the US. Actually, it was asked, Prabhupada was asked, like, did you actually go to the Western world on the Bhadra Purnima day. Prabhupada said no. Srimad Bhagavatam actually entered. The US on the Bhadra Purnima day. I just accompanied the Srimad Bhagavatam. Now you know what really happened, right? So you can understand that how the whole world changed because of Prabhupada's appearance. In fact, many devotees actually, I've heard about this pastime. There are a lot of these pastimes which are mentioned in this ISKCON world. There was actually a third world war which was supposed to be started. On that particular day, Srila Prabhupada actually entered the US, United States in Boston. And the whole situation changed, and then completely actually the Third World War never happened, and you see so many people actually becoming devotees in the world. That important, that powerful Srimad Bhagavatam is. Yeah. Okay. So that's the thing that I want to actually talk about Bhadra Purnima. Take this opportunity. If you don't have a copy of Srimad Bhagavatam, please actually get one. If you have a copy of Bhagavatam, if possible, please actually pick up and gift it to someone who you feel like is very dear to you and you want actually them to be delivered. They may read, they may not read, but if you actually, these are like time bombs, you actually keep it, someday it'll actually break, someday it'll actually blast and they'll actually get the transcendental knowledge. It's just an opportunity. You can be a part of the Sankirtan movement that Lord Chaitanya has actually started. Yeah, so whatever you can afford, you can always afford and then gift it or sell it to someone. However it works, it's fine. Yeah. Yes, Prabhu. Gaura Prabhu, any questions on Bhadra Purnima?
So
we'll get more information about this as we go along.
So Sunil Prabhuji is checking what is a golden throne, which is being mentioned here.
Ah, okay, in the Shastras. Okay, so that's actually, that shloka is there in the Srimad Bhagavatam 12.13.13. Srimad Bhagavatam is a person, right? So you can actually keep in an elevated, if you actually can afford, if Krishna comes in person, what would you do? You would actually really receive him in a golden throne and then worship him and then send him like that, right? So same thing, Srimad Bhagavatam, if you can actually afford a golden throne, you should keep it on a golden throne, the books, and then you do aarti, offer flowers, and then as a person, however you do all this aarti like chamara and everything like that, do the same way, and you gift the entire thing to somebody. But this golden throne is not actually so important. It's just to say that it's very important. It's a paraphernalia for worship of Srimad Bhagavatam. Don't have to worry where will I get for golden throne and things like that. You don't have to give, because people will actually be more interested in the golden throne than the Srimad Bhagavatam books. So they will actually be more interested to take that as a gift rather than Srimad Bhagavatam. Don't have to be worried about it. I mean, just actually, you can keep it on a tulsi leaf and then keep Srimad Bhagavatam. That's good enough. And I remember actually when Maharaj came a couple of years back, he actually gifted a few Srimad Bhagavatam to devotees. So it's a good opportunity. Don't have to worry, Sunil Prabhu, for golden throne. Yes, Prabhu. Anything Thanks. Else you see?
No, I think we can continue. Okay. So basically devotees are raising question that they're getting a lot of request now from follower of Ritviks as well to join their Bhagavad Gita classes. So in this situation, like how to ascertain that whether they are bona fide or not?
Okay, so the people who are actually connected in this group who are attending this, you will all know, at least you actually are connected to some leaders here, some devotees here. Just check with them once and then online there are so many programs happening, and then you might actually in the beginning, it'll all look the same and eventually actually might get deviated. So we have to be careful because faith in Krishna consciousness is like a porcelain ware. It's like, you know, that china ware, if you're actually broken, even if you fix it, it'll actually have that. So if you hear about bad things about people without actually knowing what is the real intention of doing such a thing, then you will actually be very confused. If somebody actually of you are already associated with such kind of people and heard these kind of things, we don't have to discuss in this group. You can always reach out to me. I can actually give you clarification on that. But at the end of the day, Krishna is there in your heart. If you are sincere and then request him, so my Lord, please guide me to the right path, things will happen in the right way. So just cross check with the devotees who are there in the parampara, at least this group actually. You can go and then tell others how it is. Otherwise, it's very difficult. I mean, they're also preaching. There's nothing wrong in that. We'll all preach. That's perfectly fine. And eventually, if they are sincere, they'll come to the right path. That's all I would say. Okay.
Yes, Prabhu. Thank you.
Okay. The next topic that I had, how are we doing on time? Okay, we have time. Okay, so the next topic I had, we covered three topics, so two more are there. Okay, this is actually a very common question. How to balance professional and spiritual life? These how-to questions are always very, very annoying in the sense like, you just do it. Right? The devotees are actually asking Prabhupada, how to get up for Mangalarati, how to actually take prasadam, how to chant Hare Krishna. So many how-tos were there. And Prabhupada said, just do it. And even before Nike actually came up with that slogan of just do it, Prabhupada actually introduced that way back in 1969. So, how does this actually work? This is actually a shloka from Isha Upanishad, the 11th shloka. It's a very, very important shloka for those who are actually working in this material world, who actually have a job. They are not full-time devotees staying in the temple, but then they are actually employed elsewhere, or they are actually doing some business, or somewhere in the material world we actually have some engagement. This is a very important shloka for people to actually understand. What does it say? Only one who can learn the process of nescience and that of transcendental knowledge side by side can transcend the influence of repeated birth and death and enjoy the full blessings of immortality. The explanation of this, the purport is pretty long, that you can actually read the Isha Upanishad. Srila Prabhupada has given very, very elaborate explanation on this. What it really means is it's like, the train runs on two tracks, right? So both of them are actually very important. You need to actually balance it in such a way. You don't give focus only on one when you are in this ashram. At least the Shastra says, Panchaswardham Vanam Rajayat, at least till 50 years, one should actually be focusing on both of these things. Not put focus too much on spiritual life, neither on the professional life. If you actually put any one of them, you're going to lose the other. But after 50 years, you can always think about, okay, I've done enough. I've seen enough in this world. I should actually start focusing towards the spiritual life more and slowly actually get into that path. But in an immature stage, don't do it. It's very dangerous. Prabhupada used to give an example we might find it difficult to understand these examples because we don't see that often in this world. At least I have not seen it much. In the villages, some ladies and all actually would carry pots on their head. They would carry three or four pots on their head, and without even holding, they'll talk and walk with something inside in the pot. How do they do that actually? I mean, how are they able to balance it? And then how does it become that it doesn't fall down at all? They are very clear about it, and they walk with normal pace, and then they keep talking and going like that. Prabhupada says that's actually practice. In the beginning, it might actually sound a little tough, but eventually by guidance, by being with the devotees, you'll learn these tricks slowly, step by step. And because of that, actually, this balancing becomes a second nature. You don't need to really struggle to think about, it's going to balance. In the beginning, it may be a little difficult for us, but eventually it becomes natural. And Prabhupada also gave once another example that he gave an example in the US about how, no matter what, how much a lady is actually overloaded with work, if she's going out, she will always make herself presentable outside. She will put whatever is necessary for her to mix in the face so that she'll actually be presentable to the outside world if she's actually a decent woman. Prabhupada gave that example to say that we need to do whatever is necessary to keep both of them balanced. Sometimes Prabhupada also used to give this tight rope walk. Somebody is walking on the rope and they are holding the stick. There's a nice story. I just want to actually share that story also, because one time there was a condition wherein there was a merchant who squandered a lot of money, actually cheated people and then got a lot of money. And then this person was caught. But apparently when he was brought in front of the king, the king knew this person. He was his classmate. He knew it very well. But now the king was actually in dilemma. He didn't know what to really do. He said, if I actually punish him, then I will feel sad. But if I don't punish him, I'm setting a wrong example for others to follow. So what do I do? So he was thinking like this for quite some time. He decided he decided that I am going to give him some kind of a punishment, but if he passes it, he'll be pardoned. So the punishment was, there were two tall buildings and there was a rope which is tied from one building to another building. So the king told his friend, look, you have made a mistake. You have to be punished, but I will give you a kind of a punishment wherein you can escape the punishment if you can. So he was told, you have to walk from this building to that building through this rope. With you can actually take a stick if you want. So this businessman was thinking, what do? I don't have an option. Anyways, either I have to die or else I have to do this. But then there's a chance that I can actually die. I mean, I can survive if I actually make it. So he took the stick in his hand. He started putting one step. He tried to balance. And whenever he used to go a little bit that side, he used to actually lift the stick on the other side. So he got some balance. So he did this. He did a little bit and he started actually walking a little bit front. And then he did this quite some time. He was actually doing it without looking at anything, just focusing on that. And then he just went on and he just walked off on the other side. And people were just amazed. And the king was very happy that his friend actually escaped death. And all the people actually surrounded him and asked him, what did you do? How did you do it? So this person actually came and explained, in the beginning, I was so scared. I thought, actually, I'm going to die. I will not be able to make this. I can't actually cross this rope. But let me give a attempt. Let me try this. Let me give a try. So he took the stick. And whenever actually there was little difficulty on this side, I balanced myself with the stick so that I put proper effort on the other side so that I was able to balance myself on the rope. But I was always looking at the destination. I was always looking at the destination, the goal. I need to get there. So he was in that kind of mood and then I balanced and just walked off. I did not see down. I did not see back. I just focused on the goal and then I just got over it. So the explanation given by the devotees is that in our spiritual life also, our goal is to go back to Krishna. As long as your goal is to go back to Krishna, Krishna will help us, number one. Number two, whenever you actually, your spiritual life is getting too much, actually, you're doing, spending too much time, give a jerk. Go do your professional life. You need to learn something, learn that. But similarly, if you're actually going too much on the professional side, you'll get dull. Then give a little bit of a jolt and then start actually practicing a little more spiritual life. Then you balance it. In the beginning, it may be difficult, but eventually you know how to balance it. Today, 3-4 years it may take, but with guidance, you'll be able to balance it in such a way that you'll be able to follow it and then you'll be able to cross the goal. That's the explanation the devotees give for this tightrope walk. That's how we have to balance both professional and spiritual life. Otherwise, it's very difficult actually. If you spend too much time on one thing, other things will get affected and there'll be people coming and complaining, right? So the other example which is actually given is, find out what is your priority, then you'll be able to do everything in your day. This is actually an experiment which was actually given to some of the students in IIM. It's a pretty old experiment. Many of you might be knowing this, but I'll just repeat it because not everyone would actually be aware of this. There was once a professor who actually visited the class. And then he gave them an experiment saying that, how do I find what is my priority? So he gave them a glass beaker, a glass vessel, and then he gave them a lot of other things, big stones, small stones, pebbles, then a lot of gravel, sand, gravel, then sand, then water. So he gave them everything. So he told them, can you actually fit all of these things inside? So what people started doing was they started actually taking everything and putting inside in whatever ways they were actually trying to put. So when they did that, not everything was actually going inside. They had something which was left out, especially the big stones couldn't go inside. So they were confused like what to do. So the professor actually started explaining. They said they took the beaker and put the big stones, whatever were the biggest ones, he put them inside. So it was all full, all the stones went inside. Then he took the smaller stones and put them inside that. So that they also went inside. Then he actually put the gravel, little bit of the coarse sand, he put them. Then he put the fine sand. Then he put the water. So the beaker was full with everything inside. So that is what actually he said, you should know what is your priority in life. If you actually know exact priority of your life, then if you fit your priorities, other things will actually fit in. So we should understand that our real priority is to please Krishna. If you please Krishna, the material world, the professional life is actually the activity of material nature. Maya Devi, she will be quiet. She will say, okay, you are actually doing whatever my boss wants. I will not disturb you. But unfortunately, what we do is we actually want to please everyone else except Krishna. Because if you don't get up for Mangala Arati, Krishna is not going to come with a gun and say, hey, but he's not going to do that. But if you don't attend a meeting at 8 a.m. in the morning with your office, then your manager will come and say, what are you doing? Right? So we try to please all these people and then we are forgetting the goal. I'm not saying that we should not actually go and do this. But what I'm trying to say is, if you take Krishna consciousness as your main priority in life, get up early in the morning, chant your rounds, and then pray to Krishna, then everything else will actually fall in its own place. You'll be able to complete everything. And then if there is something which is actually left out that we are not able to actually solve it, Krishna will actually fit in his own way. He will actually correct it, whatever is necessary. So that is what actually we should do. If you keep that, then this balancing actually will easily work. Right? So so that's all I had. I mean, there's no big, what do you call, solution for how to, nothing like that. You just have to do it. Just do it is what Prabhupada's example is. And these are some of the examples that I've heard from in my in the last 25 years. And then I feel actually this all works. As long as you take Krishna as your priority in life, everything else will actually fall into place. But if you take something else as priority in life, it's your mother, your father, your wife, your spouse, your children, anything else you take as your priority in life, then there'll be something which will not fit in. You'll not be able to complete something for sure. Because end of the day, this entire creation, entire world works under the control of Krishna. Maya Dakshina Prakriti Suyate Sachara Charam. When Krishna actually is controlling everything, he knows how to control everything. So if you take him as a priority and then tell him, these are my problems, my Lord, I find it very difficult to actually manage. But I know that I'm your surrendered soul. I want to surrender to you. You follow that properly. Everything else will actually follow. It'll all fall in its place. And even if you are not able to complete something, Krishna will actually take care of it. We don't have to be really worried. Just like how we did for Arjuna. When we know the practical example of how he told Tasma Sarveshu Kaleshu Ma Manusmriticha. He said, Arjuna, you fight. Remember me and fight. You fight whatever you can. The rest of them will take care. He did take care. He protected Arjuna so many times. And Karna actually released arrows. There are various reasons that actually when there's a story in the Mahabharata wherein there was a demoniac king by name Bhagadatta who actually had released a very, very powerful Vaishnava Astra. When Arjuna had no, what do you call, solution for that, but Krishna actually stood up and then accepted it. So he actually took that arrow on himself. So there are many things like this that Krishna would actually help. He just wants us to actually be engaged in his service, and then under the guidance of the parampara, if we simply do what is necessary, he will take care of the remaining thing. We don't have to be really worried about it. So that should be our faith, that avakshya rakshibe Krishna, that Krishna will protect me, and I have that faith. That faith we have to cultivate in our life. That is there, everything else will fall into place. We don't have to be worried, because the professional life is just our past karma. It will less come, it will go. Even if you don't do something else, it will go. But unfortunately, we are scared what will happen. Because I'm working, I'm getting the money, and because I'm getting the money, I'm running my family. It's all just our hobby. End of the day, Krishna is one who is taking care of every one of us. We should have that faith. It will not come in the beginning, but eventually we'll start getting it. Yeah. Yes, Gaurav Prabhu, any questions on this? I didn't have anything specific otherwise, because we just have to do it. There is nothing called balancing as such.
So Hare Krishna, any devotee having any question, they can unmute and they can ask right now.
Yeah, mainly take Krishna as your center and everything else will actually fall in its place. That's been my experience because everything is actually under the control of Krishna, and he will do whatever is necessary. And when you actually are making some deviations here and there, he will use that as an opportunity to teach us the lesson that is required.
Yeah, no question, Prabhu, on this. I think your points are very clear.
Okay. So there are many examples like this. There are many stories, but most of these stories are more like concocted ways of thinking. But it just conveys the meaning that we need to balance our life in such a way, at least till 50 years. After 50 years, focus more on where there's no balancing, because you're already done. Nobody wants you after 50 years. nobody would actually be interested in you. So you just have to think about our next life and go on. But till then, we actually feel that we are very important. I'm youthful. I have a lot of followers. I have a lot of friends here and there. And so many girlfriends I have, so many boyfriends I have. And I'm very important. That feeling is there. So those are all, we have to start leaving it. So you don't have to really balance after 50 years. Just forget about the professional life. Because even if you prove, nobody's going to actually give you a big award or anything like that. It's just a waste of time. Yeah. Okay, so...
Last question, sorry. So is it wrong? So if once you surrender to Krishna, does it make sense to have career aspirations, or is it just a breadwinner for us and Krishna is the priority?
Okay, so fundamentally, we know that our career is going to actually stop someday, right? We know it is a temporary world, first of all. And then whatever career we are actually doing, this is all going to stop someday for sure. So there's really actually no big aspirations we should be having in that direction. Because if you actually do that, if it is destined to you, I want to actually make sure that we understand the basic principle of our existence, right? We are not this body, we are the soul. Somehow we got a human experience, and then we need to actually take care of our body. For that, we need to work outside. And then for working outside, we have some qualification. We need to get trained on certain things. We need to actually make some money if required, upskill ourselves so that we become relevant in this world in our job, right? But if I become a CEO of a company or a CFO of a company or whatever, UFO or a company or whatever it is, would that actually make your Krishna consciousness easier? We had to ask that question. If it is not going to help us like that, then we should not be really worried about actually going in that direction. We should simply go and tell the Lord, my Lord, whatever you feel like I should be actually doing, please make that happen. I am your soul. I am your surrendered soul. I am your servant. You know what is good for me. Just allow me to do whatever you like me to do. That's all it is. Whether actually I paint a house and get $50,000, or I actually write a software code and then get $50,000, or put some pan on a betel leaf and sell and make $50,000, that is just our hobby. We should simply have a very clear understanding about my goal is to go back to Krishna. If I have to go back to Krishna, I need a career here. That career, I leave it to you, my Lord. You decide. If you think that I can become a CFO and still follow Krishna consciousness better, please make it happen. Simple. But if you take your own decision, okay, I want to become what you call the head of team and things like that, and work hard towards that. And if that is not in your karma, and Krishna is also not going to bless you, you will have a miserable life. You will never be happy there because you will not succeed there, nor will you be able to serve Krishna because you don't have time for that. So we have to be very clear about what we want to achieve in life. Does it help you, Arun Prabhu?
Yeah, I think so people for career aims and startups and I want to this and that, right? I somehow feel it's in the mode of passion, correct?
It is, but then so that is why actually you need to be in some kind of association and some kind of guidance from a senior Vaishnava. And then take it slowly. It's not wrong actually to really do some startups and things like that. Because Arjuna himself was in passion. Because if you have not actually been in passionate mode, you cannot fight. You can't be, sitting quietly and then fight in a war. It's important. But what is actually the aim? Is it wrong to actually run a startup? No, but take guidance from senior Vaishnavas. If it's your nature, you can actually just like that, without thinking like that, you can make business. Then that's good. You engage that in Krishna service. But it has to be done in consultation with Srinivas Vaishnavas. Don't do it just because your mind is telling you, oh, you are a great man. There's no other person like you. You can go and then build anything overnight. Then Maya Devi will know, oh, very good, very good. Come like this. She'll actually take you in a different direction. And finally, you'll find that I come to a place where I don't know where Krishna is. So your life will be lost. You'll not have any devotion towards the Lord. And again, punarapi jananam, punarapi maranam. That's all it is. There's no wrong in actually having a career interest, but it has to be in consultation with a senior Vaishnava. They will know by your behavior, naturally you have that kind of a business blood, then it can happen. There's nothing wrong. Not everyone actually has to become the pujari and then sit inside the temple. Not necessary. Arjuna himself was a kshatriya. Arjuna himself was not building temples. He was actually really fighting there. But then he fought for Krishna. Under the guidance of Krishna. Similarly, we can need not fight, but we can build a big software empire, anything like that, but under the guidance of our spiritual master, not on our own.
Thank you, bro. Makes sense.
Okay, so let's go to the last topic. If you don't have any other question, and the last thing I had was basically about how to increase our sadhana. Again, that's how to is coming, right? Let's understand what sadhana. Sadhana means really a dedicated practice to achieve something. If you actually are an athlete, you actually don't sleep properly, you eat proper specific things and avoid eating specific things and really struggle hard, and then you can really win races and things like that, marathon and things like that. Again, that's also a sadhana in material sense. So sadhana really means a dedicated practice for a spiritual goal. And Srila Prabhupada says, just do it. That's what I was like, trying to say in my previous slide. Anyhow to, just do it. Whatever is there, it has to be done. Yena kena prakarena. That's what actually Rupa Goswami mentions. How do I chant Hare Krishna? I'm not able to chant Hare Krishna. Rupa Goswami says, yena kena prakarena. Some more chant. If you're not able to chant, put a tape of Prabhupada chanting and listen to that. Eventually, you will start chanting. That's all it is. So, any of these how to, easiest way is to see somebody else doing. If you actually sit with somebody else who is actually attending a Mangalarati or chanting Hare Krishna better than you, associate with them, and then when they chant Hare Krishna, you will actually pick it up. If somebody is distributing Prabhupada's books very nicely, associate with them, you will actually pick up that quality. That's the easiest way to actually pick up these services. Reading Bhagavatam too, the same thing. I don't have interest to read Bhagavatam. Sometimes people say that I don't have interest to read Bhagavatam, so I don't read Bhagavatam. By not reading Bhagavatam, will you get interest to read Bhagavatam? You're not going to get, right? When you're trying hard to read Bhagavatam, you're not getting interest. Without reading Bhagavatam, how will you get interest, right? Somewhere you have to start. Somewhere you have to actually do it as a, just like brushing your teeth. The children don't like to brush their teeth when they're born, right? Mom and dad actually force them and they get it into a rhythm. Similarly, reading Bhagavatam, reading books of Prabhupada, chanting Hare Krishna has to become a practice. We need to actually do it, whether you like it or not, do it. Getting up early in the morning, you may not be able to. Of course, it depends on your job also. If you're sleeping at 3 a.m. in the morning every day, getting up at 5 a.m. is impractical. But end of the day, plan it out in such a way that you'll be able to follow these principles on the long run. So at least be aware of that. Associate with right-minded devotees, then you'll be able to actually follow it. If you're not able to follow every day, do it at least on Saturday, Sunday. Someday you need to actually give some time for the Lord and pick it up, right? Because if you want to increase the sadhana, sadhana won't increase just like that. Often the whole bhakti process is actually explained as a tree. And sadhana is actually the root. You can't have a huge root and actually a very small kothmir kind of stem, right? If you have a very, very small plant on the top and huge banyan tree kind of a root, it won't work. So you need to actually expand your service to the Lord. When you actually expand the service to the Lord will give us a taste to increase our sadhana. Sadhana really means our personal commitment that I want to do something for the Lord. I want to chant Krishna's name. I want to remember the Lord. I want to meditate on the Lord. I want to actually read about Krishna more and more. It's all sadhana basically. So I want to follow all the principles. I want to please the Lord nicely. So if you want to do all those things, you need to actually have some seva, some fruits that you are giving to Krishna, basically. Like serving the Lord, either deity worship or giving classes or distributing books, right? When you have to preach outside, people ask you questions and you need to know everything. So for knowing everything, you need to actually go back and chant. You have to go back and read Prabhupada books. Only then you'll know the right answers to give. So if you do the seva, if you pick up these different services for pleasing the Lord, then the Lord will give the taste for us so that we'll be able to actually increase our sadhana. Otherwise, there's no way to actually increase sadhana. You will not be able to because somebody is telling you chant 16 rounds, you'll get the taste for chanting 16 rounds. That's not actually a very simple thing to do. We need to actually get the taste to chant 16 rounds. Just like if I tell you everyone should eat 4 gulab jamuns every day, it's not easy to eat, right? One day you can eat, 2 days you can eat. Every day if I give, Sumit Prabhu will actually throw the gulab jamun on my face. So it's not going to be so easy. But then if there is actually a taste that you are getting, then that taste, which is actually really love for Krishna. If you are observe all these animals like cows, right? The cows eat the same grass, same hay, whatever you are putting, it eats the whole day, all through its life, it eats the same thing. If we have to eat the same khichdi every day, you'll go crazy actually. What is happening? You can't manage. Why is that freedom given to us? Why is that we actually have the kind of freedom that you want to taste different things, you want to try out different things? Because that's where your love for the Lord will come. Your love will actually be, otherwise you'll be forced. The cows and the other animals are forced to behave in a particular way. They eat the same kind of food, still happy, very satisfied, appears at least, right? But for us, we need variety. So that variety is basically to engage ourselves in Krishna service. Different ways we can engage. When you engage in that services of the Lord, you will start getting that taste actually to do our sadhana better. Just like if I eat one piece of a cake, I'm hungry. But when I eat the first piece of cake and there's no sugary taste or it's very salty or bitter, then my mindset is already gone. I don't get any taste. So I can't eat any more of the cake. Similarly, when you actually chant Krishna's names, also do some seva for the Lord, that seva will actually feed in the purity required in the heart to chant Krishna's names better. Both has to happen simultaneously. Your service to the Lord and chanting has to happen simultaneously. Only then actually you'll be able to progress in Krishna consciousness. Again, underlying principle is right association. If you associate with saints, you will become a saint. If you associate with drunkard, in the beginning you will say, I am very pure. Eventually one little bit, then one full bottle will go inside. Then you are a drunkard basically. You were not a drunkard before, but you became a drunkard eventually. Then you will know everything, what to mix, what not to mix and things like that. But associate with saints, associate with those kind of people who actually are focusing on how to go back to Krishna, you will also pick up those qualities. Eventually, you will also practice all these things. Simple, right? That is the reason, if you don't have adventure in your life, you will not feel like increasing your sadhana because there is no protection required for you. Just like the example sometimes I use is the wrestler, right? Unless until the wrestler actually has a goal, I'm going to actually participate in an event wherein I'm going to actually fight with so many other wrestlers. And then for that, he will practice it so much every day that he has a goal there. And that goal actually has to be, he has to demonstrate all his capabilities of defeating others. Similarly, if you don't go and then preach outside, you don't go and give out books outside, or I don't actually interact with anyone in the world, there's absolutely no adventure in my life. So, I mean, I sitting at home, I don't have to actually practice. I don't have to improve my sadhana. I don't have to improve my understanding about what Krishna is and things like that. So obviously you cannot be able to increase your sadhana. So that's very important. We need to put our sadhana into some service. When you do service, then you will get caught. If you don't understand Prabhupada's books, you can't answer. If you have not actually properly chanted Hare Krishna, you will not be protected. So because you're not protected properly, you'll get scared. When you actually go and then go on the street, you'll see a big billboard of some actress there and immediately you'll get, your mind will divert and say, I'm actually doing a mistake. Yeah, I'm sure I'm supposed to think like that. But you don't have the kind of energy to actually resist that kind of, posters. That way you'll go back and then chant Krishna's name better. So that is very important. We need to actually be in a preaching mode. Then it's actually easy for us to actually progress in sadhana. Yeah, so that's all I had. Is there any questions? I think.
So Anshuman Prabhuji is asking. So earlier I used to chant 16 to 20 round, but this month I see I am unable to continue the same count and I'm becoming restless and want to again start from chanting. So now it has come to 4 to 6 round. So how can we maintain that? Also, what are the sevas that we need to focus?
Okay, so yeah, so basically, always have a yardstick. You increase your rounds, don't decrease it even if you die. Because when you actually are connected to Krishna, that is why actually we have the Siksha program wherein we actually go and tell in front of the Lord, I'm going to chant 4 rounds every day. Please somehow help me. So then 6 rounds, 8 rounds, something like that. We actually have some Siksha levels wherein we actually commit in front of the Lord and the Vaishnavas that I'm going to do this. So getting to 16 rounds and coming down, then getting back will be a little difficult. So what do we do in that kind of situation? The easiest thing to do is have a calendar and put every Ekadashi, I'm going to increase one round extra. Something like that. You actually decide whatever it is under the guidance of a senior Vaishnava. Every one of us should actually have one trustworthy senior whom we can actually go and then work with. Because it's simple, like we are actually diseased. All of us are diseased right now. We all have a family doctor. So the doctor doesn't come to us and then tell us. We actually have to go and then tell the doctor, I have this difficulty. So if you actually have that, when they tell you, please do this, we do it. We should do it. If you don't do it, then there's no way actually we can get cured. So these are actually given in the Shastra saying that one must actually take association of a senior Vaishnava and take the guidance. Something like we can put a calendar, but if you independently without anybody's guidance you're trying to do it, Maya Devi knows, so it's your weakness. Very nice. So some days she'll allow you to chant 8 rounds, some days she'll not allow you to chant at all. So many other things will come in your life that you don't have time. So that's what I said, the priority is something we have to decide. My priority is, okay, if chanting of Hare Krishna is something that I'm committing to the Lord, I'm going to chant. What it means is everything else will actually be secondary. That means before others wake up, I have to finish my rounds as much as possible. So when I do that, then the Lord is actually happy. Okay, the remaining actually is all taken care of. I mean, whatever has to happen will happen. We don't have to be worried. But someone who's fallen down, to increase it, just put a calendar. Okay, every month I'll actually increase one, or every Ekadashi I'll increase one and come back to 16 rounds. That's what I would actually say, because the Lord is watching us. He knows when we commit Vaishnava Aparad, when we actually have we take the Krishna conscious process very lightly, then the Lord actually takes away the taste for chanting Krishna's name. When you do Vaishnava Aparad, you lose the taste for chanting Krishna's name. You'll not be able to chant Krishna's name. So you should actually be careful. Work with the senior authority, whomever you trust with, then you'll be able to get back to the normal chanting. Was that the only question, Prabhu? Was there any other question along with that you actually asked, Guru Prabhu?
Yeah, there is one more question.
What are the seva you mean?
On his part here, what are the sevas that we need to focus? Okay. So I think because of lockdown, we are not getting devotee association. So I think that may be the reason Prabhuji is basically losing on the spiritual aspect.
That's true. Unfortunately, we are in the kind of situation wherein that's why we have so many of these Zoom sessions and things like that. It is not exactly the same like in-person meetings, but make the best out of the bad bargains, because not everything actually will change overnight. But whatever is available, attend Mangalarati, chant with the devotees. When you actually see others chanting, others struggling, you also feel that I'm actually on the same place, and then you can actually definitely make some progress by associating with other devotees. And service-wise, like for example, Bhadra Purnima is coming. So when you actually gift a Bhagavatam set to somebody else, or you buy a Bhagavatam set, something like that, the Lord knows actually you are trying to help him spread this message. So he gives you some purity in your heart that you can actually chant back nicely. So these are sevas. The sevas keeps coming. For example, we have this Janmashtami seva which came. Radhashtami is coming. So hearing about Srimati Radharani, serving Srimati Radharani, feeding some Vaishnavas on that day. So something like that, when you actually do some activity, or on those days you can actually sponsor. I'm not able to actually go and distribute books, but I want to distribute 5 Bhagavad Gitas. You people, if you can actually distribute on my behalf, please do that. When we do that, the Lord notices these things. Okay, if you're not able to do that, okay, those all required, money is required. Okay, you can always decide, okay, what else can I do? Can I actually at least send a message of Krishna to 5 other people? Just forward those messages to 5 people. They like it, they not like it, it's okay. But at least you have tried your best. So those are the sevas which are definitely actually useful, and you make progress by doing those sevas. Yeah. Yes, so, Guru Prabhu. If we actually have in-person association, that's the best. But unfortunately, I don't know when things will change.
Yes. So we have one more question from Chetan Prabhu. What he's checking is that basically his understanding is like Karma Yoga is doing sadhana in material work and Bhakti Yoga is in spiritual. So how to balance both?
Basically we follow the Bhakti Yoga. It's Karma Yoga is not actually the right thing to do. The difference is that I've been giving this example for quite some time. Karma Yoga and Bhakti Yoga looks very similar. The only difference in activities is that in Karma Yoga, you do whatever you like to do and offer the result to the Lord. In Bhakti Yoga, you only do whatever the Lord wants you to do under the guidance of a senior Vaishnava. Simple. The activity is the same, but for example, eating food. You cook whatever you like, offer it to the Lord and take that as prasad. That's called Karma Yoga. But you cook whatever the Lord wants under the guidance of Sri Vaishnavas, because the Lord actually has revealed certain things which he likes. So you just cook that and you just accept that as prasad and then take it. That's called Bhakti Yoga. So the difference is very simple. The difference is that in Karma Yoga, you are still the center. You are dovetailing whatever you like in the service of the Lord. In Bhakti Yoga, the Lord is the center. I am useless. I am actually insignificant. I am just a servant of the Lord. I will do whatever the Lord wants me to do. Again, under the guidance of a senior Vaishnava, not independently. The senior Vaishnavas will actually tell you, based on what they have heard from their senior Vaishnavas, what is the right thing to do. You simply do that under the guidance of spiritual master. Then that's called Bhakti Yoga. You don't have to balance it. Full life, you are working in the office. The result of that work is money. Engage that in Krishna service. That's Bhakti Yoga. You don't have to actually really think that that's Karma Yoga and then Bhakti Yoga is only ringing the bell and chanting Hare Krishna. No. Your work also is Bhakti. Just like Arjuna was actually fighting in the war. He was not actually holding a bell or chanting Hare Krishna. He was actually shouting and then shooting arrows. But that's considered as Bhakti Yoga because he was under the guidance of Krishna directly. Similarly, if you actually take guidance from a spiritual master or his representative and develop a software, that is also Bhakti Yoga. It all depends on whose guidance you are taking. That's all it is. It's your own mind which is guiding you, or you're actually taking the parampara guidance. That's all actually matters. Hope that helps, Chetan Prabhu.
Yes, Prabhu.
No questions?
Sumit Prabhuji was raising one question personally.
Mm-hmm.
So basically, he's checking that Purushottam month is coming.
Yes.
So what all that we can follow for our spiritual progress on that?
Purushottam Adhikamas, right? Purushottam Adhikamas is coming in a very short while. That's an extra month which actually comes. It's very, very useful for spiritual life. Just like your Damodar month, whatever we do the same thing on Purushottam month also. Lamp offering, get up a Mangal Arati, chant extra rounds, eat Bhagavatam. Whatever you can do for Krishna, the spiritual life, with your available time, do that. If you attend Mangal Arati, that's actually good. You actually offer a lamp, ghee lamp for the Lord, very nice. So, and then distributing books. Think about various ways, what can you do to actually spread Krishna consciousness? What can I actually do extra to actually distribute Prabhupada books? And thinking on all these things actually is very, 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 very beneficial. You will actually become more closer to the Lord because the Lord actually understands that you are taking his headache. Krishna actually has a headache. What is his headache? His headache is that all of us, the conditioned souls, are stuck here and we don't want to go back to Krishna. So when you actually are taking some effort to engaging others in Krishna service, then he becomes very, very pleased, saying that you are actually taking my headache and trying to bring everyone towards me. I'm very pleased. So he actually gives us the mercy that is required for us to progress towards him. Yeah. So yeah, Purushottam Adhikamas, you get more benefit from normal days. Yeah, a lot of you can actually chant the 15th chapter of Bhagavad Gita, which is called the Purushottama Yoga. Like that, there are many things which actually are there. The devotees will start actually posting in the group. You can actually start reading them and make progress towards it. See, this information is all there for us. We'll keep getting, but we must actually try to take it and follow it. If we don't follow it, we cannot blame Krishna for it. We cannot say that I'm not able to follow all those things because I don't want to follow. That's all it is. If we actually put our effort, Krishna will help. They say, right, there's actually saying in the Bible, they say, God helps those who help themselves, something like that, right? Guru Prabhu, do you know what is the...
Yes, yes, Prabhu. God help those who help themselves, yeah.
Yeah, so that should be the same thing. If you actually try to do things of that nature, you will actually be able to make progress. Yeah. Anything else, Prabhu?
So we have one question from two questions basically. One from Vamsi Prabhu. So he basically started joining Kudlu Bhakti Vriksha sessions from last 2 weeks that are online. So he's saying that how I can find association of senior Vaishnava because I am living near Malleshwaram.
Yeah, so at this point in time, because of lockdown, we are in various parts. I know some people from Calcutta actually joined Bhakti Vikshas here. And some devotees, wonderful devotees across India actually joined some of the groups. I know that I've heard about this. But eventually, we'll find out. Krishna will actually help you people to get connected to some devotees who are very close to you, wherein you can attend programs. Near Malleshwaram, we have the ISKCON Seshadipuram, very close by in Seshadipuram. So there are devotees who will actually be able to guide you and help you out. Don't have to worry. At this point in time, since you actually just joined, you can actually have connection with the devotees whomever you're actually talking to over phone and things like that. Krishna will actually help you. Don't worry. See, because the Lord is actually more interested in taking us back to Him. We are not the only one who are trying to go back to the Lord. So it's just a matter of time. Have patience. Whomever you actually connected to the BV group leader, talk to that person only. They are actually the right person to talk to you right now. And if they are not able to answer, they will actually talk to their seniors to get you help. So don't have to be worried about that. Yeah.
Yes, Prabhu. So next question is basically from Sushil Kumar Prabhu. So okay. He's checking that if, for example, someone is chanting less than 16 round and is reading one chapter of Bhagavatam and Bhagavad Gita, both per day, can that be considered equivalent to chanting 16 round?
Driving, it's like actually having sambar, sadam, and what you call some other guju or something, and saying that I've had full meal. No, actually, it is not the same. But whatever you're doing, tell the Lord, this is what I'm able to do right now. The Lord will actually guide you in the right path eventually. He's a person. Talk to Him. I mean, reveal your heart to Him. He will actually guide you, basically, in the sense. Reading Bhagavatam one chapter and then one chapter of Bhagavad Gita every day and then chanting 14 rounds is not equal to 16 rounds of chanting Hare Krishna. It is whatever it is. It's not that you can actually convert this. Oh, that is add 2 there, multiply 3 here and then get an equation, say you got 100. No, that's not the right thing to do. You chant, the recommended is that Prabhupada said, if you're loving Krishna, the minimum thing that we can actually tell that to declare Krishna that I love you is basically chanting 16 rounds and following 4 related principles and whatever we can actually do in the service of the Lord. If you tell somebody I love you and then you don't give any gift to that person is not going to accept you that you are actually loving him. So the minimum level, how do I know actually I love Krishna? So the minimum level that the Prabhupada actually has set, minimum standard that Prabhupada has set to say that I actually love Krishna is to chant at least 16 rounds every day and follow the 4 related principles. When you do this, it shows that from the Acharya perspective, it shows that you're actually a lover of Krishna. Yeah. But what you're doing is definitely better than someone not doing at all. So it doesn't count as 16 rounds, but you should actually come to the level of 16 rounds whenever it's possible. Keep praying to the Lord. He will actually give you the guidance to do how to do it. Krishna mentions Tesam Satyuktanam Bhajatam Priti Purvakam Dadami Buddhi Yogam Tam. Krishna is saying, if you actually serve me with love and affection, not as a burden, with love and affection you do it, Dadami Buddhi Yogam Tam, I will give you the buddhi with which you can come back to me. Yena Mam Upayantite, you can come back to me. I will give you the guidance how you will come back to me. But we should actually take one step at a time. You take one step at a time, it will happen. So you don't need to feel very bad that I'm not able to do it, but inform the Lord I'm not able to do it right now. Please help me how to get to that. Yeah.
Yes.
Hope that helps.
Yes, Prabhu. So, Prabhuji, actually earlier we were having Vyuha session where all the devotees were assembling together and like they were sharing their experience. They're talking with each other.
Yes.
So, Pransaki Mataji has requested that like other devotees, if they want to share their experience attending Bhakti Vriksha. So, we can request devotees basically who are now attending Bhakti Vriksha to unmute themselves and they can share their experience of attending Bhakti Vriksha and how it is helping them to spiritually progress so that others can also benefit. They can take enthusiasm listening to you all.
Sure, Prabhu. Go ahead. I mean, you can actually.
Meanwhile, we got one question also from Meera Mataji.
Okay. So should I take the questions or somebody wants to actually share some of their experiences?
Let me once check. So Hare Krishna, any devotee, they would like to share their experience who are attending Bhakti Vriksha regularly? They can unmute themselves and they can speak on that. It is better rather than putting on chat. Meera Mataji, you want to speak something? Hare Krishna. I'm audible to everyone, right?
Yeah, you're audible, but they are scared. I'm going to go off from the spotlight.
Hare Krishna. Anyone wants to share what is their experience attending Bhakti Vriksha?
There are 49.
Hello.
Yeah, Hare Krishna.
Yeah, Hare Krishna Prabhuji, Gaurav Prabhuji.
Yes, Prabhu.
This is Sunil here.
Yes, Prabhu.
Yeah, I just wanted to quickly share. I just started a few months back attending the sessions. And obviously, you know, I always look forward to these sessions because it's surely some association which was not there before. So that is surely a big positive. The only thing is, as I think we have been discussing, that it's not an overnight process for sure. I mean, that's what I'm realizing. As somebody said, 10 years it takes and so on. So that's what I'm facing right now. I think there are too many whys and hows and maybe laziness or whatever you want to call it, because of which the car is not moving. You know, there is maybe there is something missing from my side which I need to still do. But I think the association is really the key. And I think today also it was discussed that without association, I think it'll not happen. And that's what I really cherish, that I look forward to that. Yeah. And hopefully I will also improve personally. Yeah. Thanks.
Thanks, Prabhu. So we have Sunil Prabhu speaking on his experience. He's attending Adarsh Pam Bhakti Vriksha. Now, like, we are having online sessions. So he's attending online session and he's very inquisitive. He always raised too many questions. So that is a good thing. So we, in a spiritual path, one should have questions. One should be open about it. Thanks, Prabhu. Thanks.
Very nice, Sunil Prabhu. Definitely. See, as devotees, we should actually pray for each other. For their progress, we should actually pray to the Lord that such and such person actually get your mercy, my Lord. Let them also be convinced about the path and let actually they make progress towards you. So that's something that we all have to do. That's why actually when you chant Hare Krishna, and the Lord will actually ask you, what do you want? So this is something that you can always ask, saying that please make everyone actually your devotees and things like that. Yeah.
Yeah, I can see Santosh Prabhuji has also unmuted himself. Santosh Prabhu.
Yes, Prabhuji. Yes, Prabhuji. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna, Prabhu.
Hare Krishna. I mean, I just want to share my experience and the change that has gotten to me. My friends come and tell me, like, they used to call me Sandy. Sandy, for you, you've come a long way from on Saturdays, planning Saturday nights out. You're all stuck into spiritualism, and you are into this bhakti. I feel that for myself, it's a great achievement that I've done. I'm getting out of this material world because I was a party person altogether, and it's got a 360 degrees change in me. I've quit drinking, I've quit smoking, and you know, it just happened. That the change has come automatically, and it is so seamless that it doesn't feel like I was ever addicted to it. And thank you for the association, and thank you to Bhakti Vriksha.
Yes,
thank you so much.
Thanks, Prabhu. So Santosh Prabhu is also introduced by Meera Mataji to Adarsh Pam Bhakti Vriksha. So now, like, we are having online programs. So even though he's not based in Bangalore, but he's attending. And I can see he's progressing very quickly. he is following Ekadashi as well. Even though like he has a strict office schedule, he tries to follow Ekadashi and chanting as well. And whatever programs that are being conducted right now, whether it's Janmashtami programs or other programs, he is very regular and punctual, and he's working hard to progress on the path toward Krishna.
Wonderful.
That
wonderful.
Is precisely the change you're talking about, Prabhuji. And thank you again. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Yeah, that's wonderful. Definitely. Always remember, this is actually the blessings of the Lord. This past, whatever we were, we should always remember that how I was, how I have changed right now. Keep remembering that and never leave the association of devotees, because Maya Devi will actually test all of us. Are we ready to really go back to Krishna? She will put us into various different companies, various different associations, various different situations, wherein life will become tough. But as long as you are with the association of devotees and then you are following these principles and instructions, you will come unscathed. You will not have any difficulty because Krishna will actually protect us. But don't expect it will be a cakewalk. Pandavas were struggling so much actually. It was not so easy. But they had Lord always with them. That's what we should actually be aware of. Thank you so much, Santosh Prabhu.
Thank you. And I feel why it is, you know, the Lord is with me, because when people get off the vices, they have withdrawal symptoms as well. But to me, luckily, it was so seamless that I don't feel like I was ever addicted to these things. I mean, I don't miss them at all.
Yeah.
When I'm doing the chanting and everything.
Very nice. Super. So that's actually one of the effects of chanting Hare Krishna. We lose all the bad qualities automatically without even making a big endeavor.
Good, Prabhu.
Yes. Thanks, Prabhu. And we have Rajeshwari Mataji has posted that Hare Krishna Prabhuji, I am attending Pransakhi's Mataji class daily. It's going on very good and learning lot many things. And I'm enjoying the devotional path. I thank each and everyone. My obeisances to all the spiritual masters.
Hare Krishna.
Basically all the Vaishnavas, yeah.
Stay in touch with Mataji.
Yes. Then we have one question from Meera Mataji. We'll quickly take that.
Okay.
Because Meera Mataji is also attending the Bhagavad Gita program from Seshadripuram that is being conducted. Mm-hmm. So let's take her question. What she's checking is that if we wear Tulsi Mala, is it offense to sometime take coffee? I'm trying to go off coffee, but at times if I do, then how to go about it? Likewise, we are learning and trying to do seva in any form. But we may not be able to do as strictly as per regulations, like not having tulsi to put on prasad at night. If I cook and offer to the Lord and eat post sunset, I don't take tulsi and forget to pick before sunset.
Okay. So these are more like details which are there. See, our past bad habits don't go so easily. It's not that just because I'm actually wearing Tulsi Mala and then wearing a Vaishnava dress with tilak and things like that, I become pure like a sannyasi and things like that. No. Our past actually really disturbs us many a times actually because of our past habits, which are not actually devotional at all, will again creep in here and there. The Lord knows it. Only thing is we need to actually be repentative, saying that, okay, when will I ever change? I'm not able to give up these things. So it's so difficult and things like that. As long as we pray to the Lord, please help me, my Lord, and things like that, we will be able to overcome all these things very quickly. It's not that difficult. But that mentality should be there. We should not be in a mode of enjoying material sense gratification. Because if you actually are enjoying, then we will not get that mercy from the Lord. When you actually are repentative, you actually are praying to the Lord to help and protect, then you will be able to overcome that. But don't feel bad that, okay, I'm breaking. It's just like a small child who's actually starting learning to walk. The child will fall down for sure. But if you demotivate the child saying that, okay, you will never actually be able to walk, don't walk at all, then the child will never walk. Actually, he'll always be crawling all the time. So have patience. Don't feel bad that actually I'm still not there. But you will become one day, actually, it will take some time. But if you keep actually practicing it, one time you'll fail, two times you'll fail, 10 times you'll fail, but eventually you'll actually be able to follow it. It all depends on your spiritual progress and association. When you actually see others following, you'll also be able to follow it. Should not be a problem. But again, so these details around Tulsi not being offered and things like that, we can actually have alternate plans. You can actually have Tulsi dried and put it in a box. And then whenever you want to actually offer it, you don't have to go and pluck it from the plant. You can actually buy Tulsi from outside, dry it and keep it in a box. And then you can offer that also for emergency. The Lord accepts it. He knows it. You don't need to actually go and then pluck fresh Tulsi every time. That's not actually needed. So there are various ways you can actually check with some of the Matajis to actually help you out how to do the offering. You should be able to do it. The Lord will accept it. The mood is what is important. But if you don't offer Tulsi at all, then the point is, we all know the Lord is not interested in our food. He is interested in our devotion. He's interested in the Tulsi that you offer. So when he sees the Tulsi, he becomes very happy and he picks up. So that's actually the explanation the Acharyas give. That's why Tulsi has to be offered whenever you're actually offering food to the Lord. I know some devotees in the Western world, they put their own Tulsi mala, whatever they're actually chanting in the offering, and then take it up and then do it. But those are all extreme things. But I think we actually be able to manage with other things. Like, you can actually buy some Tulsi outside, dry it, put it in a box and keep it. And then you can offer the dry Tulsi as part of your offering any point in time. Yeah. Hope that helps, Minamati.
Yes. So Mataji is saying, thank you so much, Prabhuji. Your guidance is really so important for me. Since the start, we'll follow that. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna. Prabhupada ki jai.
So any other devotee want to share any of their experience? Anshuman Prabhu, I see you have unmuted yourself. You want to speak?
Yeah, Prabhuji. Actually, earlier I was looking for some spiritual groups and all. And I was joining whatever WhatsApp group, many forwards is to come and everything. But I was unable to devote time to those groups or spend time. But in Bhakti Viksha, when it started, the doubt slowly, the session was elaborate and doubt was very much, it was cleared. So all questions are answered and it's cleared. And slowly, I see that now I am able to devote the time. And also, so I'm trying to now recently, from today, I started my daughter also to chant Hare Krishna. So today was his first day to start the Hare Krishna mantra.
Very nice.
Today she started, and slowly I saw that even my daughter is chanting, then my son is also started to join. Though he's very young, but he's also starting to join. So I see that more positivity is there, Miss. I'm feeling, and at least I'm. Anyhow, I'm trying to devote this 5:30 to 7:30 Saturday, and it keeps me all my doubts clear, and it keeps my that spiritual level a little bit high.
Very nice. May Krishna bless your children. Definitely, be in association. You will actually learn everything. It's just a matter of time, but all depends on association. If you actually leave the association, you will not learn anything, because nobody in the world is actually really taking time to explain us about who we are, where are we coming from, where are we supposed to go. Nobody's talking about that. Everyone is thinking about, how will I get more money from you? What can I do? What can I get from you? How can I exploit you? This is what everyone is thinking about. So don't leave the association of devotees. Even there are difficulties, please don't leave the association of devotees.
Yes. So Anshuman Prabhu is basically attending Adashpam Bhakti Vriksha sessions, but he's very serious, I can say, because from the starting only his question was like, how I can take initiation, like how to follow the siksha path, and like how I can identify the spiritual master. So I can see he's very serious on the path to devotional service. So thanks, yeah. Anshuman Prabhu.
Yeah, many things actually, what really happens is Krishna is in your heart. If you sincerely make a prayer, my Lord, I want to come back to you. Please help me. All these sessions will actually, you will be wondering like, how come actually I didn't ask this question? How are these kind of questions being answered here? Because the Lord is there in your heart. He knows what is your real problem, and he'll start actually getting the right answers. Those kind of things will be discussed. You'll be wondering like, how is it possible? But then that's how it works. When you actually open Srila Prabhupada's page to read it, you'll get the right answer. You'll be looking for it, and then you'll get the answer like that. Because the Lord is there in the heart and he connects everything like that. So it's very important that you be in association of devotees. Then everything will actually be answered. Eventually, everything will actually become perfect and you'll be able to reach the destination. Yeah.
Yes. So I think Sandeep Prabhuji is speaking on similar line. He's saying that Hare Krishna, currently I'm attending Gaurav Prabhuji's Bhakti Vriksha. What I feel is when we actually start thinking about Krishna with devotion, many things arise in our heart and we get our answer knowingly or unknowingly during Bhakti Vriksha classes, which connect our mind more with Krishna. Thank you so much for the guidance. Dandavat Pranam.
Yeah, Jai Shri Prabhupada. I mean, this is all Krishna's mercy on all of us, all the conditioned souls. Many people don't understand Krishna properly at all. It's our responsibility to get trained and then also give this knowledge to others. Thank you very much. Yes. Sarana Prabhu, is your group also there? Are they all dropped off?
Yeah, some of the new members have dropped off, Prabhu.
Swati Mataji, I can see. Swati Mataji, you want to speak something?
Yes, Prabhuji. Hare Krishna. Dandavat Pranam.
Okay, Satyamati.
Yes, I'm part of many groups, Prabhuji. And one is Sarvana Prabhu's group. Then I'm part of Pransaki Mataji's group, where we have the Bhagavad Gita Shloka reading. And also in the evening, Ranchur Prabhu and of course, Aprajit Prabhu's group. All I can say is each are different aspects and it helps you, you know, different aspects, Prabhuji. And in Sarvana Prabhu's group is, and with, you know, the way we read it and do it, you know, it's like you read it, you read the thing, then you have to assimilate it, you discuss. And then with Aprajit Prabhu giving his inputs also, you know, it clarifies a lot of doubts. Wonderful. You know, and in Pransaki Mataji's group, Prabhuji, let me tell you, I have been trying my best to read the Bhagavad Gita on my own. It's not worked at all, and some simple things I have had such misconceptions, and it's like it's just getting clarified as I read. I'm still a neophyte. I don't consider myself progressed to that extent as others have. But I'm learning. And regarding the Bhagavatam classes, the Krishna, which we are doing the 10th chapter, 10th canto now, very interesting, Prabhu. And it's nice. You know, it gives you a purpose in life. That's all I can say. Hare Krishna.
Thank you, Satyamataji.
Hare Krishna. So Sunil Prabhuji is asking that how to buy Srimad Bhagavatam on September 2nd.
You will start getting more information about this. And as you go on, the Bhadra Purnima festival start, you will get more information about it. All going to be online. You can actually book online, pay online. It will get delivered also online. I mean, in person, it will get delivered. So wait for some more time. You'll start getting the details.
Okay. And then Hema Mataji from Adashpam Bhakti Viksha, she's saying that Hare Krishna, our love for Krishna is growing due to great association. I think Rajeshwari Mataji has excellently
unmuted. No problem. Sure. I think this group is a very nice group. And the Saravana Prabhu's, yours, Ranchur Prabhu's, and the many other our Uttam Mataji's group, Pransaki Mataji's group. Who else is there? Vinita Mataji's group is there, and then our Sanatan Prabhu's group also is there. Right, all of them actually are trying to please our Guru Maharaj, Prabhupada. It's really definitely, I mean, don't think actually it'll all go waste. All of you, whatever you are trying to actually help, this is definitely actually going to please Prabhupada on the long run, because you're all actually taking whatever you have learned and giving the knowledge to others and bringing them towards Krishna's instructions. This is actually how I came into Krishna consciousness about 25 years back. So some great soul actually gave me this simple knowledge, and then I somehow got pulled into this whole thing. So now you're all trying to do the same thing. So it's definitely actually, it'll go a long way. Definitely Guru Maharaj, Prabhupada, the whole parampara will be actually very, very pleased with whatever you people are doing. Continue to do it, but have patience. Don't expect people to change overnight, because many a times this happens and I become a devotee. My spouse is not a devotee. Spouse is not actually favorable and things like that. don't feel bad about it. Keep praying. It will take some time. It may not happen one day. It may take 1 year, may take 10 years, may take one lifetime. But nevertheless, because you are becoming a devotee, others will also become a devotee. It's just a matter of time. Just have patience. That's all it is. Yeah.
Yes, bro. Thanks. Any yes. other devotee want to share anything? Their experience?
No problem. I mean, okay. there's nothing else. If there anybody has any question, they can always actually message me directly, Gaurav Prabhu. Or if,
yes,
if, I mean, all these devotees are there. I know, like, I mean, all the devotees are well trained. So you could actually talk to your Bhakti Viksha leaders, and they should actually be able to guide them. If there are any other specific questions that is really required, let us know.
Yeah.
I think it should be good, Gaurav Prabhu. We are good.
Yes.
Thank you so much. I would actually thank all of you. Hare Krishna, for taking time and then attending these programs. Continue to do this. We should pray for each other's progress, and thereby we can remind each other that our goal of life is to go back to Krishna. Thank you so
thanks,
much.
Thanks, Kripa Mahaprabhu, Prabhu, for giving your time on this Saturday. And definitely it was a very nice session. We have around 60 devotees, those who have attended this program from all the Bhakti Rikshas. So you'd like to chant you by chanting one time Hare Krishna Maha Mantra.
All of us.
I'd like to thanks. Yeah, all of us can unmute and we can just chant one time Hare Krishna.
For all of our benefit.
Yes.
For all of our benefit. Yeah. Yes.
Hare Krishna, 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 Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare.
Thank you, Gaurav Prabhu, and thank you, everyone. I'm dropping off right now.
Thanks.
Thank you, Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
Thank you, Prabhuji.
Hare Krishna.
Thank you.
Thanks. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna, Prabhuji.